In this video, I will cover and debunk most of the myths, misconceptions, and revisionism on Italy during World War II. Wikipedia is not an extremely reliable source when dealing with history, but a good part of these points I'm making on fascist Italy is covered and supported by the English Wikipedia, which is based on Anglo-American anti-fascist historiography. This says a lot about the nature of misconceptions, which are usually perpetuated not by historians but by ignorant. I will not go in great details for each of the points I'm making, as the sources and publications on them are not hidden nor difficult to find, in case one would like to know more. I will focus on the Italian fascist forces, but the video is not affiliated with any political party and does not endorse any ideology. It purely talks about history. There will be criticism towards both who fought for fascist Italy and who fought against it. Let's start with the biggest misconception. Italy switched sides during World War II. This too simplistic sentence is neither true nor false. But if I had to, I'd pick false, and I will explain you why. First of all, it's quite a naive question for obvious reasons. In World War II, the Kingdom of Italy was a country with 45 million inhabitants. It's absurd to think that all of them supported the same ideologies. This goes for every country, of course. There were Nazi French, fascist Brits, and anti-Nazi Germans. But for Italy, this goes even further. Italy is the last World War II country, you could say everyone was pulling in the same direction. At all points of the war, there were considerable numbers of fascists and anti-fascists, plus a large part of the population who had neutral views towards fascism. Let's put the events in chronological order and describe them briefly. 25th of July 1943, the fall of fascism. Mussolini receives a vote of no confidence during a session of the Great Council of Fascism. In reality, some members of the council and King Vittorio Emanuele III were plotting this result since time. One shouldn't make the mistake of believing that Mussolini had no more support in Italy. He was getting less and less popular because of the military defeats. The Allies had conquered Sicily and the Axis was retreating on every front, but he still had supporters, both in the council and outside. The majority of the council, including Mussolini's son-in-law Galeazzo Ciano, wanted to depose Mussolini so that a peace treaty with the Allies could be signed and Italy could drop out of the war, and therefore voted for the no confidence. Few still believed that the war could have been won, or at the very least wanted to keep Mussolini in charge in victory or defeat, but they were the minority. And there were also few of the no confidence voters who didn't want Italy to surrender to the Allies, but wanted to put somebody else in Mussolini's place, hoping that a more military competent leader could change the tide of the war. But the king and the other council members already made up their minds. The day after, while Mussolini went to the king's residence to report the result of the meeting, he fell into the king's trap. He was arrested and imprisoned. In Mussolini's place, the king named Marshal Pietro Badoglio. Badoglio assured the Germans that the Royal Army would continue the war alongside Germany, but was actually setting the terms for the peace treaty with the Allies. For over 1 month, the Italian Royal Army was in standby, taking part only in defensive operations abroad, with the exception of few Blackshirts units, who kept actively fighting for the Germans. 8th of September 1943, the armistice. The armistice between Italy and the Allies is announced on this date. Italy officially surrenders to the Allies and becomes a neutral country, dropping out of the war, at least in theory. This is where one of the biggest misconceptions or revisionism comes by. No Italian division started fighting for the Allies on the 9th of September. In reality, Germans already knew of the armistice well ahead of the 8th of September, even before most of the Italian military, thanks to their spies and to the fascist Italian officers who informed them. Therefore, after the armistice was made public, the German divisions were the most ready to act. The Italian army was mostly left with no orders by the officers and abandoned to its fate by the king and Badoglio, who were busy escaping from Roma to the Allies-controlled southern Italy. The Allies were also slow to react. They expected things to pan out differently. They didn't believe Germans could react so quickly and expected Italian divisions to immediately start fighting alongside the Allies, something that didn't happen, since Italy was now a neutral country. As a result, Germans occupied Italy and began Operation Achse, in which German divisions confronted Italian troops to usually give them three choices: to keep fighting for the Axis, to peacefully surrender their weapons and equipment and accept imprisonment, or to not comply and be forcefully disarmed. Great majority of the Italian army, left with no orders, chose option number 2, to be peacefully disarmed and imprisoned. Some chose to forcefully resist, only to be defeated and subsequently imprisoned or executed, like the infamous Acqui Division. Of course, some chose to continue the fight alongside the Germans, and some divisions managed to evade the Germans and make return to Italy without ever confronting them. Completely different situation was for the Black Shirts. They were elite fascist troops who answered directly to Mussolini. Even with them formally not existing anymore after the fall of fascism and with an imprisoned Mussolini unable to communicate, almost the totality of the Black Shirts refused to obey Badoglio and immediately sided with the Germans. There were very few battles between German and Italian troops, most notably the Battle of Roma, in which Germans successfully took possession of Roma, defeating the Italian Royal Army divisions stationed in that zone. Italian officers didn't even bother calling to arms every available division to try and defend Roma, for example the Centauro Division. Stationed outside of Roma, many officers believed they would have sided with the Germans and helped them take over the city. All of these rare clashes between German and Italian troops came from Italian troops refusing to comply with German orders. In no case Italian troops attacked Germans. The only exception could come from Sardinia and the South Mediterranean Sea, in which the Italian Royal Navy and few other units were involved in anti-German operations, but even among them there were Italian units who refused to obey the orders and sided with the Germans. 12th of September 1943, the Gran Sasso Raid. Hitler wanted to rescue Mussolini from imprisonment. The whereabouts of Mussolini were being kept secret. The king wanted to avoid Black Shirts or Germans assaulting the prison Mussolini was being kept in to free him. But the German intelligence, aided by sympathetic elements of the Italian forces, soon found out that Mussolini was being kept prisoner in a hotel on the Gran Sasso, a mountain in central South Italy. With a daring operation involving glider planes, Otto Skorzeny's German troops successfully raided the hotel and freed Mussolini. The only casualties were two Italian guards stationed far away from the hotel, who were killed to prevent them from calling for reinforcements. 10 German soldiers were instead injured in the crash of one of the gliders. 2 machine guns were mounted on the hotel roof, but they were mysteriously unmounted and hid away before the arrival of Skorzeny. Alongside the Germans, there was Fernando Soletti, an Italian police general, who easily convinced the Italian troops guarding the hotel that this was a planned operation. After the war, Soletti declared himself a hostage during the Gran Sasso raid and not a collaborator, for obvious reasons. This shows how many Mussolini loyalists were still around, often only appearing to follow Badoglio's orders. 18th of September to 23rd of September 1943, the creation of the Italian Social Republic. Hitler wanted Mussolini to be the head of a new Italian state that could continue the war alongside Germany. Mussolini wasn't particularly willing in leading such state, probably understanding that the war was lost and that his role was over. Reportedly, Hitler threatened Mussolini with the destruction of few northern Italian cities if Mussolini were to refuse, very probably a bluff. Hitler wanted Mussolini's charisma to guide Italians and convince them not to surrender to the Allies, but Germans had no reasons to destroy important industrial cities that they owned, nor to make their presence in Italy even more unwanted by the Italian population. Moreover, other Nazi sympathizer Italians were ready to guide this new state in Mussolini's place. On the 18th of September 1943, Mussolini announces on Radio Monaco his return, the king's betrayal and the creation of a new state. On the 23rd of September, it's official, the Italian Social Republic is born. Also known as RSI, Repubblica Sociale Italiana, or the Republic of Salò, name taken from the town of Salò, where the head of the new fascist government would be. The Italian Social Republic immediately started reforming an army, based on more than 100,000 Black Shirts, who never stopped actively fighting for the Germans, and units of the Italian Royal Army who opted to keep on fighting for the Axis. Soon the army would become much bigger, but I'll talk more about this in later points. The Italian Social Republic immediately declared war on the Allies. It was a country at war from the moment of its birth and claimed sovereignty on the whole Italian territory. Therefore, after 15 days of official neutrality, Italy re-enters the war on the Axis side as the Italian Social Republic. 13th of October 1943, the Kingdom of Italy re-enters the war. The armistice between Italy and the Allies implied that Italian forces would need to collaborate with Anglo-American forces. Since German divisions were already in Italy, there was no such thing as completely dropping out of the war. The Allies expected Badoglio and King Vittorio Emanuele III to comply with their orders after the armistice and to immediately declare war on Germany. But both Badoglio and the King were reluctant to do so. By this point, they were not on board with Mussolini's plan anymore, but that didn't mean they were big fans of the Allies. The British and American commands were frustrated because of the idling and the continuous refusal by the King and Badoglio to declare war on Germany. Vittorio Emanuele III didn't want to give up any foreign land that belonged to the Italian Empire prior to the war, while Badoglio, other than not liking having to obey Anglo-Americans, didn't want the Italian army to act as a sacrificial lamb for the Allies. He would have rather seen Italian divisions being disarmed and taken prisoners by the Germans than seeing them being slaughtered. The day in which Badoglio finally gave in the demands of the Allies is the 13th of October 1943, more than 1 month after the armistice, after Germany took control of the majority of Italy and after the Italian Social Republic was formed and declared war on the Allies. The Italian soldiers who stayed loyal to the King and who managed to evade German capture formed the Italian Co-belligerent Army, also known as the Army of the South. The Army of the South ended up being a relatively small army, around 1/5 to 1/4 of the size of the Italian Social Republic forces, and mostly acted as support to the Allies in South Italy. From this point until May 1945, the co-belligerent army will fight on the Allies' side and the National Republican Army on the Axis side, even though they would rarely clash against each other. Majority of anti-fascist Italians ended up joining the large resistance movement in central and north Italy, rather than the Army of the South. To recap, 25th of July 1943, the fall of fascism, Mussolini is imprisoned and Marshal Badoglio takes his place. 8th of September 1943, armistice between the Kingdom of Italy and the Allies, Italy becomes officially a neutral country. 23rd of September 1943, the Italian Social Republic is formed and immediately resumes the war alongside Germany. 13th of October 1943, the Kingdom of Italy, or what remains of it, the Kingdom of the South, enters the war on the Allies' side with a much smaller army compared to the RSI army. So, not even for a single day of the war, there was only one Italian army fighting alongside the Allies. The very large resistance movement is to be considered for the majority formed by citizens and rebels who didn't swear loyalty to anybody. Not being a regular army, they fought for whoever they believed right. More about the various armies and partisans that fought in Italy will be explored later. It's ironic that the myth of Italy having no honor and switching sides has always been perpetuated, mostly by Anglo-Americans, when it was the Allies who demanded in vain the Kingdom of Italy to immediately switch sides after the armistice. When the Kingdom of Italy did declare war, it was only after the formation of the Italian Social Republic, and the Italian pro-Allies forces have always been outnumbered by the Italian pro-Axis forces, especially if we consider only regular armies. But this series of events has been mostly forgotten and it's often omitted and blurred, mostly by post-World War II Italians of different ideologies who wanted to hide the considerable fascist presence up until the end of the war, but also by nationalist and revisionist post-war Anglo-Americans who, just like they did with France, did their best to bring down other countries' actions, just to bring up their own at the eyes of the world. Fascist Italy was defeated by Ethiopia. The Ethiopian army was made by spear-wielding soldiers. Italy had to use mustard gas to defeat Ethiopia. This isn't a myth perpetuated by historians, rather by ignorant amateur enthusiasts. Let's make a brief summary of the wars that occurred between Italy and Ethiopia. International historiography usually recognizes three of them. 1887, the War of Eritrea. 1895, the War of Abyssinia. 1935, the War of Ethiopia. English historiography gives different names to these wars, calling them all Italo-Ethiopian wars. As fascists rose to power in Italy in 1922, it's clear that between fascist Italy and Ethiopia there was a single war, the one of 1935. Let's briefly talk about these wars. The War of Eritrea of 1887 is the lesser known of the three. It was the beginning of the Italian colonization of Africa. The Italian aim was to establish a colony in today's Eritrea, which then belonged to the Ethiopian Empire, and transform Ethiopia into an Italian protectorate. Because of the distance, the difficult logistics, and the fact that this campaign wasn't well received by the Italian population, the Italian government tried to obtain maximum results with minimal effort and minimal cost. Therefore, the number of soldiers deployed for the campaign was a fraction of the Ethiopian forces. In all battles of the War of Eritrea, hundreds of Italian soldiers had to fight against thousands of Ethiopian soldiers. Italian troops were met with early success, also taking advantage of the fragmentation of the Ethiopian feudal system. Italian troops conquered Eritrea and tried to advance further into Ethiopia, but were pushed back, losing few battles against an enemy that fought fiercely and that greatly outnumbered them. Very bloody battles were fought in this war, with many deaths on both sides in relation to the numbers. In the end, the Italian troops failed to advance further into Ethiopia, and a peace treaty was signed, the Treaty of Uccelli. Eritrea was now an Italian colony, but Ethiopia maintained its independence. While Italian, German, and most of other historiographies consider this campaign an Italian victory because of the conquest of Eritrea, English historiography considers the resolution as a compromise, because not all Italian aims were fulfilled. The War of Abyssinia of 1895. This is the famous war from which the myth of Italian troops being defeated by spear-wielding savages was born. Let's put it into context. The Italian government used an orchestrated breach of the Treaty of Uccelli as an excuse to wage a new war against Ethiopia, still trying to make it an Italian protectorate. Once again, the Italian infantry, after all in 1895, there was not much else that it could have been used other than infantry, was heavily outnumbered. Most of the troops fighting for Italy weren't even Italian. Around 90% of them were Ascari troops, Eritreans fighting for the Kingdom of Italy. Another misconception is that Ethiopians were a spear-wielding army. The Ethiopian Empire was one of the most powerful, if not the most powerful, African nation, and its large army was indeed equipped with firearms, for the majority at least. The Ethiopian army also had cavalry units, and units using spears, swords, and bows. It is estimated that the Italian-Eritrean forces were outnumbered 4-1 by the Ethiopian army, if we count only the firearm units, 8-1 if we count also the units with other types of weapons. Another misconception is that the War of 1895 was a tentative by Italy to invade Ethiopia, which is not correct. An initial invasion did happen, with Italian troops conquering the Ethiopian Tigray region. The Italian government wanted to convince, or rather force, the Negus Menelik II, the Ethiopian emperor, to allow his country to become an Italian protectorate. The invasion of the Tigray region was a way to put pressure on him, threatening him with a full-scale invasion. But it was just a bluff. Italy didn't have enough troops in Africa for an invasion, not even close, and the Italian government was unwilling to spend more and to send more divisions. The Negus Menelik II didn't fall for the bluff and commanded a large counterattack. Once again, the forces of the Kingdom of Italy had to fight forces even 30 times their own size in battle. Therefore, the Italian-Eritrean troops were being pushed back into Eritrea from the Tigray region. The battle that ended the war was the infamous Battle of Adwa. The Italian general Oreste Baratieri had around 17,000 troops at his disposal, opted to engage the Ethiopian troops, even without having detailed maps of the zone. More importantly, Baratieri estimated to face around 30,000 or 40,000 enemies, while in reality in Adwa were present more than 100,000 Ethiopian soldiers. After a bloody fight, the Battle of Adwa became a decisive Ethiopian victory and one of the worst Italian military defeats. A peace treaty was signed, Italy kept Eritrea, but gave up the idea of Ethiopia becoming an Italian protectorate. At least until 1935 and the War of Ethiopia, which was the only war between fascist Italy and Ethiopia. Mussolini wanted to finally achieve what his predecessors failed to do, and deployed the actual Italian army to invade Ethiopia, alongside the Eritrean Ascari troops. This time things were completely different. Italian troops weren't outnumbered anymore, rather they were almost double the size of the Ethiopian army. There was also a bigger technological difference. The previous two wars were fought almost exclusively by infantry. This time the Italian army brought vehicles, tanks, planes and plenty of artillery. The mountainous nature of the Ethiopian territory meant that tanks had quite a limited role, and the Ethiopians deployed artillery as well, but the difference was still huge. While in the previous two wars Italy attacked Ethiopia only from Eritrea, this time it was able to create two fronts, attacking from two different Italian colonies, Eritrea and Somalia. This war was more symbolic than anything, a propaganda tool used by Mussolini and the regime. Mussolini knew that for the propaganda to be effective, Ethiopia should have been heavily defeated. The League of Nations, especially Great Britain and France, condemned this aggression against Ethiopia and economically sanctioned Italy, but that didn't slow the war down. It just became another tool for fascist propaganda and for the alliance with Germany. The Ethiopians put up a fierce resistance once again, at times managing to slow down and even push back smaller Italian forces. Their defense was also advantaged by the mountainous terrain, allowing the troops to disperse, hide and ambush quickly. But it was all to no avail, because in 1936 Italian troops enter in the Ethiopian capital city, Addis Abeba, and occupy it, ending the war and annexing Ethiopia into the Italian East Africa. Ethiopian resistance continued even after the end of the war via guerrilla, but it would be the Allies in World War II the ones to eventually defeat and occupy the Italian East Africa. Let's talk about the usage of mustard gas by the Italian army, which was a weapon banned by the Geneva Protocol and therefore the usage was a war crime. There is no doubt that a certain amount of mustard gas bombs were used by the Italian Air Force, but in this day and age, great majority of historians of all nationalities agree that the usage of mustard gas was rather limited, and especially was not decisive for the Italian victory. This is also proven by the fact that gas masks were quite rare among the Italian lines. The mustard gas used in this war was very volatile and easily transported by the wind, which means that if Italians opted for heavy mustard gas bombings, they would have needed to equip a great amount of soldiers with gas masks. Mustard gas also had the tendency to stick to the ground for a good amount of time, so that it would have been effective on someone who would come into contact with it even several hours after the bombing. But the numerous Eritrean Askari troops often preferred fighting barefoot, which means they would have been hit by the effects of the mustard gas as well, but that didn't happen. Ethiopian records about these are highly unreliable and usually come from the local leaders, the victims of the bombings. Some records even describe herds of livestock running away from Italian mustard gas bombings and throwing themselves off cliffs, which is not how mustard gas worked at all. Other than the fact that Italians didn't have interest in destroying a land that they intended to have as colony. Of course, English historiography of the time, being anti-fascist and anti-Italian, tended to believe these reports and make up new ones, suggesting that Italians used mustard gas in a massive fashion and that their victory was to be attributed to that. But when one looks at the numbers of the field and the deaths of the campaign, understands how far apart were the two armies and how devastating the Italian victory was, making the usage of mustard gas superfluous. So why was mustard gas used then? During the war, the usage was being kept secret by the Italian military, but the international press, also thanks to the Red Cross, soon found out. The official reason given by the fascist regime was that the mustard gas usage was in retaliation to the Ethiopian troops torturing Eritrean prisoners and using dum-dum bullets, a type of bullet designed to expand when inside the enemy's body, making the injury more serious. Both of these are confirmed Ethiopian war crimes during the war. But in reality, knowing communications and telegrams between Mussolini and the various Italian generals, the mustard gas deployment was planned all along. Mussolini instructed his generals to use it only to break the spirit of the Ethiopians when their resistance was particularly fierce. But historians believe it's very probable that the gas would have been used nonetheless, as some sort of experiment for a weapon to use in future wars. Italy wasn't the only Western country to resort to mustard gas in those years, but it was the only one to use it in a proper war, unlike Great Britain, which used it in anti-rebel operations in few of its colonies. To recap, Yes, Italy lost a war against Ethiopia in 1895. It's not correct to call it an invasion of Ethiopia though. No, the Ethiopian army was much better equipped than a group of spear-wielding soldiers. No, fascist Italy didn't lose a war against Ethiopia, it achieved a devastating victory in 1936, and no, the usage of mustard gas wasn't decisive at all. Mussolini could have joined the Allies, or Mussolini should have joined the Allies. This is a myth perpetuated by people who ignored the nature of fascism and the political situation in Italy in the 20s and 30s, but also by modern-day Italian nationalists and neo-fascists in an attempt to put some distance between Mussolini's fascism and Hitler's Nazism. There was absolutely no chance for Mussolini and fascist Italy to side with the Allies against Germany. There were two main reasons. The first reason was what happened at the end of World War I with the Paris Peace Conference. The Paris Peace Conference of 1919 gave birth to treaties that expected harsh punishment towards the losers of World War I. The Treaty of Versailles was used by Nazi propaganda to gain support in Germany and increase the population's resentment towards the victors. It's less known that something similar happened with Italy. The Kingdom of Italy had little reason to enter World War I, and the vast majority of the population wanted the country to remain neutral, especially when Austria-Hungary was refusing to give up most of the lands Italian nationalists were asking for, in case Italy would have joined the war alongside Austria-Hungary. The King of Italy and the government, ignoring the will of the people, started negotiating with the Triple Entente, with Great Britain promising Italy a territorial gain in case Italy were to enter World War I against Germany and Austria-Hungary. Therefore, the government signed the Treaty of London in 1915 and entered World War I, selling the will of most of Italian people and sending hundreds of thousands to die at the front. Italy became a sort of a mercenary country waging war against Austria-Hungary, and basically only Austria-Hungary, for a relatively minimal territorial gain. I will talk more about this in the next point. At the end of World War I, with the defeat of Austria-Hungary, the Triple Entente, especially American President Wilson, refused to give Italy the promised lands in case of victory because of the secret nature of the London Treaty. This caused a lot of resentment in Italy towards Great Britain, France and the United States. Italy fought World War I exclusively to gain the wanted territories that belonged to Austria-Hungary. After so much spilled blood, only a portion of them would have been assigned to Italy. This created the concept of the mutilated victory, perpetuated, among others, by Mussolini and Italian poet D'Annunzio, who went as far as occupying the Yugoslav city of Fiume, today's Rijeka, with a group of volunteers. It was a key concept for the rise of fascism in Italy. So already by 1920, the future Allied countries weren't seen in a good light in Italy. There was more resentment towards them than towards Germany, considering that Italian and German units barely ever met on the battlefield in World War I. The economic sanctions against Italy from the League of Nations for the Italian invasion of Ethiopia in 1935 just confirmed that Great Britain and France were enemies of fascist Italy. They were seen as hypocrite countries that owned large colonial empires but didn't want Italy to have its own. With the signing of the Pact of Steel by Italy and Germany in 1939, Italy's fate was definitely sealed. The second reason was an ideological reason. Fascist Italy and Nazi Germany were ideologically close, as Nazism is considered a form of fascism. But here's a difference. While Adolf Hitler considered communist Soviet Union to be the biggest enemy of Germany, never mind the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, for Mussolini it was different. Mussolini's views were more anti-capitalist than anti-communist. Fascism is a nationalist ideology, which has always been considered far-right, but unfortunately in this modern era, many associate it with capitalism, which is wrong. This often happens in Anglo-Saxon countries, in which right-wing equals heavy capitalism. But fascism was born in 1920s Italy, not in an Anglo-Saxon country. Fascists defined themselves as an alternative to communism, socialism and capitalism. They despised socialism and especially communism because of their class warfare nature, which was seen as a danger for the nation. Rather, Mussolini advocated class distinctions among nations. Italy and Germany were proletarian nations, while Great Britain was a bourgeois nation. Capitalism, in Mussolini's words, was a product of a decaying society. This is something that even Italian neo-fascists of today haven't grasped, as they support capitalist right-wing individuals, something an actual original fascist wouldn't have done. Mussolini didn't see Great Britain, France and the United States as democracies, rather as plutocracies. He thought it didn't matter who the people voted for. In the end, the government would have been the same, capitalist and Freemason. Mussolini's reason for the dictatorship in Italy was exactly this, to prevent it from ever becoming a capitalist plutocracy. One could consider socialists and communists to be the main opponents of fascism during the 20s in Italy, but abroad Mussolini's disdain towards capitalist Great Britain, France and the United States was far bigger than his disdain towards the Soviet Union. Maybe because Russia was a faraway land that never had quarreled with Italy and was even outside the borders of the old Roman Empire, Mussolini mostly ignored Soviet Union. Of course, when the time came, he was ready to send a large army to aid the Germans in the invasion of Soviet Union. After all, there was a war to be won. But even then, Mussolini always suggested Hitler not to focus so much on the Soviet Union, rather to focus on the British Empire. There won't be peace in Europe as long as the British Empire exists. One just had to take a look at the fascist propaganda to see who the main targets were. As France was defeated rather quickly, most of the propaganda was anti-British, sometimes anti-American, rarely anti-Soviet. So no, there were no chances for Mussolini or fascist Italy to join the Allies against Germany. Mussolini might not have loved Germany that much, but for sure he hated the Allies, especially England. Specifically England, as he often saw even Scotland and Northern Ireland as victims of the English. One could maybe suggest that Italy should have remained neutral during the war, which is a much more sensible suggestion. After all, Italy was heavily unprepared for the war, and Mussolini himself didn't expect a war to begin so soon in 1939. But then again, considering the expansionistic views of fascist Italy, being neutral would have hardly done anything for them. You can't form an empire, nor have virtually total control of the Mediterranean Sea by remaining neutral. Italian soldiers were confused on why they were fighting for the Axis. This is something you sometimes hear American history enthusiasts say, and it's connected to my last point. Of course, every soldier had his own mind and everyone was different. You had a large range of ideologies and beliefs in an army, especially in a fragmented population like the Italian one. But no, there was not as much confusion as some believe. I'll give you one example. I found this article about the Italian army in Russia for Operation Barbarossa, the sad story of a conscript Italian army that froze to death while fighting Russia, written by Michael Peck for the magazine The National Interest. The National Interest is an American conservative magazine, so it shouldn't be surprising to find revisionist articles on it, in my opinion. I find a couple of sentences in this article so bad they're amusing. The soldiers of the German master race didn't think much of the emotional Italians, a feeling reciprocated by Italian soldiers, some of whom would rather have been fighting the Germans than being their allies. What does suggest that Italians would rather have been fighting the Germans other than Anglo-American revisionism? In World War I, not even the nationalist Italian irredentists cared much for Germany or for their Triple Entente allies, let alone the majority of people who were forced to fight at the front against their will. Imagine being from Central or South Italy and being sent to fight against a foreign country you had no business with, to gain small pieces of land and cities you never heard of. All of this, of course, with immediate execution in case of refusal. It was solely a war against Austria-Hungary, which now didn't exist anymore. Italians had little reasons to fight alongside the Entente in World War I and had absolutely no reasons to side with the Allies at the start of World War II. Nobody wanted to fight for the Allies because there was too little hate towards Germany and too little love towards the Allies. A smart thing to suggest would be that most Italians would have preferred remaining neutral, which is probably true. In the 1910s, 1920s and 1930s, Great Britain, France and the United States didn't do much to be loved by the Italian population, so even the anti-fascist and anti-Nazi sentiments that a good number of soldiers had would rarely translate into pro-Allies love. Anglo-Saxon historiography likes to suggest that Italians felt for some reason closer to English and Americans rather than Germans. Apart from personal views that each of the millions of Italians had, this ignores the almost 1,000-year-long Holy Roman Empire, which included a good portion of Europe, including German and several Italian regions. Even in World War I, there were Italians who actually fought alongside Austria-Hungary. 100,000 soldiers from South Tyrol, whose first language was Italian but living in a land under Austria-Hungary, fought for the Triple Alliance. And of course, this implies that fascist propaganda didn't have any effect, which it had. As a cherry on top, the article concludes with, "The 8th Army returned home to Italy in March 1943, 6 months before Italy surrendered to the Allies. By September, Italy would be at war with Germany." Wrong. In September 1943, Italy surrendered and then rejoined the war on the Axis side as the Italian Social Republic. Only in October, more than 1 month after the armistice, the Kingdom of the South, meaning the portion of the Kingdom of Italy controlled by the Allies, would declare war on Germany and by proxy the Italian Social Republic. But not mentioning the Italian Social Republic and making it sound like the Italians couldn't wait to take orders from the Allies to fight against Germany is typical of this type of revisionism. The Italian army was stronger than the French army. Another myth perpetuated by Italian nationalists and so-called neo-fascists, their blind hatred and ignorance. They sometimes suggest that since France was technically defeated by Germany and Italy, and since the Battle of France lasted only 1.5 months, with France surrendering in June 1940, then the Italian army must have been stronger than the French one, which is a very silly thing to suggest. The amount of time a country resists against an invader is in relation to many factors, the biggest one being the numbers and equipment of the invaders. A quick example, the invasion of Norway lasted 2 months. Was therefore the Norwegian army stronger than the French one? Absolutely not. And the biggest reason for that is that the German forces deployed in the Battle of France were 30 times the size of the ones sent to Norway. With that out of the way, let's take a look at the times Italy and France fought in World War II. The Kingdom of Italy practically entered the war two-thirds through the Battle of France on the 10th of June 1940, invading southern France through the Alps and bombing specific locations in France, Corsica and Tunisia. But Italian troops were able to penetrate only 30 kilometers into France before being stopped by a force half their size, while the majority of the French army was being defeated in the north by the German advance. Let's not make the mistake to consider this a full-scale invasion. Mussolini knew that the defeat of France was near anyway, and that the Italian army wasn't ready for a proper war yet. That's why he waited for the opportune moment to send Italian divisions for a small symbolic invasion. Like Mussolini stated, "I only need a few thousand dead so that I can sit at the peace conference as a man who has food." The French army and government were surprised as well by the Italian attack, maybe not realizing the amount of anti-French and anti-English fascist propaganda going on in Italy since the 20s. The Alps, like in every mountain warfare, were an advantage for the French defenders, but the Italian army was still under-equipped and unprepared that even Mussolini and Italian generals were surprised by the little progress made by the Italian troops in South France, and that a quite smaller French force was able to stop them. Nonetheless, the day of the French defeat came, thanks to the Germans, and to find more fighting between Italy and France, we need to go forward to 1944 and 1945, with numerous small-scale battles between the attacking Free French forces and the defending Italian Social Republic Army in the Alps. The Italian National Republican Army, even if outnumbered, managed to successfully repel the French attacks multiple times, but in the last stages of the war and the final Allied offensive against the Axis, these small battles turned into the Second Battle of the Alps. Americans joined the battle alongside the French troops, and Germans joined alongside the Italian troops, until the final defeat of the Italian-German forces between April and May 1945. The Italian Social Republic Army was unable to maintain possession of French territory, but was able to repel French attacks from the Italian region Valle d'Aosta. In the end, both the French and the Italian militaries in World War II were victims of later myths, misconceptions and revisionism, especially of Anglo-Saxon nature, and were much better than how they were perceived today. Raiding an army is never an easy task, as there are no standard wars to take as an example, but in no way, shape or form could the Italian army be considered overall better than the French army in World War II. 30,000 British soldiers defeated 150,000 Italian soldiers in Operation Compass. The numbers are correct, but let's look into this. In the 1940-1941 North African campaign's Operation Compass, a small British force defeated a large Italian force. What many don't understand is the reason behind this. First of all, these are the numbers of an operation, not the ones of a battle. There wasn't a single battle in which 35,000 British soldiers defeated 150,000 Italian soldiers. Let's go with order and give a little context. Operation Compass started as a response to the Italian invasion of Egypt of September 1940. The numbers were around the same, 150,000 Italian soldiers against 40,000 British soldiers, but with a key difference compared to Operation Compass. During the Italian invasion of Egypt, there wasn't a huge difference between the Italian and British order of battle, meaning that they were for the most part infantry with some armored brigades and tanks. The British knew they stood no chance against a much larger Italian force attacking from Libya, and decided to retreat for the most part rather than fight, giving up a good chunk of Egypt to Italy. Indeed, the battles of the invasion of Egypt are few and of small scale. 3 months later, though, Operation Compass started, a British counter-offensive with more or less the same number of soldiers, but a much different result. It was one of the worst defeats of the Italian military, and the reason is quite simple. While the order of battle of the Italian troops stayed more or less the same, for the most part infantry with few motorized brigades, the British offensive was guided by small, fast, motorized armored units who were able to rout any infantry unit. This was the big advantage that allowed the minor British force to defeat the major Italian force. Without the motorized advantage, British infantry didn't even try to defend Egypt from the larger Italian infantry. In a certain sense, this operation is similar to the Battle of France, in which France was expecting to fight the German invaders using World War I tactics, but the motorized German Blitzkrieg took the French by surprise, making trench warfare and the Maginot Line quickly obsolete. The difference between the armies in North Africa was even bigger though. The operation was fought on flat, arid and desertic lands, with no woods and only few more mountainous zones where to set up a proper defense. If the offensive would have taken place in Europe, for example, things would have been different, as hills and mountains are an equalizer of forces, and actually advantage the defender. Having a motorized superiority wouldn't have mattered as much. But in the plains of North Africa, even a large infantry had little chance to slow down well-equipped armored units. As Italian General Sebastiano Gallina stated regarding the lost battle of Sidi Barrani, the battlefield was infested by a mechanized army against which I had no weapons. When the battles took place in more mountainous zones or against actual armored Italian units, the difference was far smaller, like in the Battle of El Mejili. Another difference was the actual Italian capability of having a good number of armored units. Italian generals were expecting a British counteroffensive, but were not expecting this level of motorization. Rather to see once again British infantry supported by armored brigades. That is a reason why majority of the Italian armored vehicles sent in North Africa were anti-infantry tankettes, designed to be effective against enemy infantry, but rather useless against enemy tanks. Various British officers and revisionists counted these vehicles as tanks to inflate the size and the strength of the enemy and therefore the prestige of the victory they achieved. The point is that even if Italian officers knew about the real nature of the British operation, there's not much they could have done about it, as the Italian industry simply didn't have the capability of producing as many tanks as they could in England. And even the equipment of the Italian infantry was inferior compared to the Commonwealth one. Italy had an empire, but Albania, Libya and East Africa can't be compared to the British colonies and the Commonwealth. To make matters worse for the Italian army, thanks to Mussolini, the troops were split between North Africa and Greece, with the invasion of Greece beginning right after the invasion of Egypt ended. In the end, after some devastating defeats and some closer battles, a large number of Italian soldiers were taken prisoner, but there were units that managed to retreat into Libya, even with the British armored divisions chasing them. Between December 1940 and February 1941, vast majority of the Italian North Africa was lost, even though some Italian units were able to resist until March. The Libyan capital Tripoli and few other towns were still defended by a couple of Italian divisions, but even though their defeat was near, the British stalled, being overstretched and their tanks starting to wear out. Before the British could attempt to attack Tripoli, the German Operation Sonnenblume would begin in February 1941, under the leadership of Erwin Rommel. The Axis counteroffensive would push the British out of Libya once again, with Italian units performing much better under the German command. To sum it up, a fair statement would be that in the arid plains of North Africa, a small motorized British force defeated and routed a large Italian infantry force. That represented a total victory for the Allies until the beginning of Operation Sonnenblume, but sounds a bit less impressive when given the context. the Greek army was stronger than the Italian army. Once again, we talk about the overall strength of an army, which is never easy to rate. In North Africa, Italians had the short end of the stick, trying to defend with mostly infantry a vast arid plain against a quick motorized force, the worst possible scenario. In Greece, Italians had the short end of the stick once again, this time being the invaders rather than the defenders, and having a motorized advantage, but with a completely different terrain. The Italian invasion of Greece happened through Albania, with the Greek-Albanian border being an impervious, mountainous region with only few practicable roads. The Italian army in Albania was larger, more motorized and overall better equipped than the Greek one, but the Greeks had a huge advantage of an easily defendable mountainous territory, in which the Italian motorized superiority became almost useless. To make matters worse for the Italian army, Mussolini opted to invade Greece, while a good portion of the army was fighting against the British Empire in North Africa. The British gave Greece aerial support through the Royal Air Force and few infantry units. Another problem for the Italians in Albania was logistic. While Greeks were able to fight at their own border, Albania became part of the Italian Empire only 1 year prior to the invasion. And since Italy and Albania didn't share a border, every logistic matter was slower and more complicated. Mussolini clearly underestimated Greece, which ended up being a big mistake. After the initial penetration into Greece, the Italian forces were stopped and pushed back into Albania by the courageous Greek army. Here we come to the question, was the Greek army overall stronger than the Italian army? The answer is absolutely not. Greek soldiers did fight better and fought more fiercely, and managed to repel a larger, stronger side, but this doesn't make the Greek army stronger than the Italian army. As stated, the Greek-Albanian border was a great advantage for the defenders, and we must not forget a very important data if we're talking about overall strength. Greece was virtually using its entire army, which was amassed at the Albanian border, leaving the rest of the country almost undefended. The Italian forces in Albania were larger than the Greek army, but they only made up around 1/5 of the whole Italian army. The whole Greek army was effectively able to repel 1/5 of the Italian army, which was a great accomplishment for the Greeks, but the overall size of the Italian army was much bigger. This was easily proven when Italy still had plenty of troops to spare for the simultaneous invasion of Yugoslavia, and when Germans invaded an almost undefended Greece from the Bulgarian border, since the almost totality of the Greek army was amassed at the Albanian border. Greek soldiers fought fiercely, something that was recognized even by Adolf Hitler, and they're rightfully considered among the bravest soldiers of World War II. But to consider the Greek army superior to the Italian one is wrong. Italy failed to invade Greece through Albania, but would have Greece been able to invade Italy? The only way to do it would have been through landings in South Italy, having to face a much larger navy and a much larger and more motorized army in an open fight, in a foreign country with much slower and more difficult logistics. The Greek army wouldn't have probably been able to take a single Italian city. They were able to push Italian troops back into Albania, even taking parts of southern Albania, but the front was standing still for long periods of time, because the Greek army knew that a large offensive into central and northern Albania would have seriously overstretched their forces, with a risk of catastrophic consequences. A stronger, larger invading army that fails to defeat a smaller defending army is not unique to the invasion of Greece. An example is the Winter War of 1939 between Soviet Union and Finland. Soviet forces were double the size of Finnish ones, with 4,000 tanks and 4,000 planes against 30 tanks and 100 planes. But the Russian-Finnish border, made up of large forests with very few roads crossing it, leveled the field, allowing the Finnish troops to defend effectively, inflicting heavy casualties to the Soviets. But would anyone say that the Finnish army was stronger than the whole Red Army, which counted millions and millions of soldiers, or that the Viet Congs were stronger than the US army, or that the Spartans could have defeated the whole Persian army? Of course not. Greeks fought better and won, but didn't have a better army. They wouldn't have been able to invade Italy by themselves, nor they would have performed better than the Italian army outside of the Greek borders. Mussolini sent Alpine mountain divisions to Russia Among the bad decisions that Mussolini took, sometimes the choice of sending the Alpini to Russia for Operation Barbarossa is mentioned. The Alpini were mountain divisions, considered among the best of the Italian military, and three Alpini divisions were among the 230,000 men who were sent to aid Germany and the other European Axis countries to invade the Soviet Union. It's baffling how some modern days history enthusiasts consider this an absurd decision, not realizing that even the Wehrmacht deployed its Alpine divisions for Operation Barbarossa. The Alpini were of course used to fight in the mountains, a terrain completely different from the Russian steppes. But let's ask one question. Which of these divisions would have been more suitable to fight in the meters of snow of the harsh Russian winter? A regular Italian infantry division, barely equipped for normal combat and unequipped for harsh winter conditions, or an Alpine division, used to snow, able and equipped to fight in harsh winter conditions? Of course, the second one. For the Alpini, it would have been better to fight on the Caucasus, as they were expecting to do so, but to consider them more inappropriate for Operation Barbarossa compared to the regular Italian infantry is wrong. The Alpini were the Italian troops that performed the best in Russia, and among the Axis troops that performed the best in Russia. The Alpini took part in various successful defensive battles on the River Don for one whole month, even when outnumbered 10-1, eventually being forced to retreat when the Soviet encirclement began. Two of the three Alpini divisions were destroyed in the Battle of Novopostoyalovka. After intense fighting and a bloody battle, they paid the ultimate price by covering the retreat of the 3rd Alpini division, the Tridentina. The Tridentina led one of the most tragic retreats of human history. Italian, German, Hungarian and Romanian units who survived other battles joined the retreat of the Tridentina and marched for 300 kilometers for 9 days in the freezing cold conditions of the Russian January, with many injured soldiers, little food and little ammunition left. The Red Army didn't want the huge column of Axis troops to leave Russia and kept surrounding and attacking the troops led by the Tridentina division. The Axis troops survived 25 bloody battles in these 9 days at a great cost, until the final attempt from the Soviets to stop the Axis retreat, the Battle of Nikolaevka. The Axis troops were more than 50,000, but only a small fraction of them were in fighting conditions. The Alpini of the Tridentina division led the charge once again through the Soviet encirclement, and after yet another bloody battle, they were out of Soviet territory. They were able to bring home few German, Hungarian and Italian infantry units fought alongside them, but at an enormous cost. When the retreat started, the three Alpini divisions counted 60,000 soldiers. After the Battle of Nikolaevka, only 13,000 survived. Of the 230,000 Italian soldiers sent to Russia, only a little more than half will make return home. Operation Barbarossa failed because of Italy. This is a myth that has been debunked by modern-day historians multiple times, so I'll briefly talk about it. The theory is that with the failed invasion of Greece, Italy in a certain sense forced Germany to intervene in the Balkans, invading Yugoslavia and Greece. This operation would cost valuable time and delay the beginning of Operation Barbarossa, the invasion of Russia, causing the Axis to be unable to make the hoped progress before the arrival of the harsh Russian winter. This situation delayed the Axis, but there are plenty of more important reasons why Operation Barbarossa failed. First of all, neither the invasion of Yugoslavia nor Operation Barbarossa were impending necessities for the war, rather they were Hitler's choices. Italian failure in Greece was also partially compensated by the Italian army in Russia, strong of 230,000 soldiers sent to aid the German campaign, even without Mussolini having a particular grudge against the Soviet Union, since he always thought that the enemy the Axis should focus on was the British Empire. Mussolini wasn't even aware that Hitler had in mind of attacking the Soviet Union so soon. Moreover, after the quick intervention in Greece, Germans were able to move a good number of tanks and vehicles from the Balkans to the Eastern Front. It's widely accepted that the biggest problems for the Axis troops in Russia was logistic, because of the immense land they were trying to conquer. Every kilometer of advance meant one more kilometer of travel for any type of supply destined to the Axis troops, and one more kilometer for every soldier and every vehicle destined to the front lines, leading to a very dangerous overstretching. I let you imagine the conditions of the roads and the railways, when there were any in rural Russia. Mud, snow, ice, rocks, all worked for the Soviet Union. The long distance was also an advantage for Russian soldiers and partisans to set up ambushes and sabotages. When Russian troops were retreating, they were retreating in other immense Russian regions, but when the Axis troops were advancing, they only walked deeper into the wolf's den. The second biggest problem was probably the equipment of the Axis armies, apart from the German one. The Alpini divisions performed well, but most of the Italian infantry was out of its league and unequipped for the harsh winter. The Hungarian, Romanian and other Axis countries' armies sent to Russia weren't small in numbers, but apart from few more elite units, they were badly equipped as well. The German command either overestimated the equipment of their Axis allies or underestimated the Soviet army's one. During the counteroffensive in Operation Uranus, Operation Little Saturn, and the Ostrogozhsk-Rossosh offensive, the Soviets knew who to aim at. The Hungarian, Romanian, and most of the Italian army completely collapsed, allowing the Soviets to penetrate deep into the Axis lines. Another aspect we must not forget is the desperation of the Soviet army during this campaign. The ferocity of the Axis invasion made Russians understand that there were only two possible choices: defeat the Axis or die. Cornered, they were able to bring out inhuman strength and willpower, which was recognized by German officers too. Finally, while Operation Barbarossa did start too late, it also made up some time in the first clashes. The Red Army, still unprepared, was heavily defeated in the first battles of Operation Barbarossa by the Axis armies, which reached Leningrad and Stalingrad faster than they thought would be possible. But the same Leningrad and Stalingrad would become two very long sieges that ultimately failed to conquer the cities and led to the Soviet counterattack. The Italian military was the weakest Axis military. Many people not too knowledgeable on history see the Axis as the alliance of just three countries: Germany, Italy and Japan, completely ignoring Hungary, Romania, Slovakia, Croatia and other countries on the German side. If we count these countries in this sort of rating, then in no way, shape or form can Italy be considered the weakest. None of these armies, except from the German and the Japanese, can be compared to the Italian army in terms of size, motorization and equipment. But what if we limit the rating to Italy, Germany and Japan? Was Italy the weakest of the three? Short answer, yes. Overall, Italy was indeed the weakest, but not by the amount that many believe. With Germany out of the question, being overall by far the strongest Axis country, in Anglo-American historiography, armies like the Italian and the French ones are often underestimated, while armies like the Japanese one often overestimated. Maybe some are led to believe this because Japan was effectively the last Axis country to surrender, or maybe because American historiography tends to boost the Japanese army to inflate the American accomplishments in the Pacific theater. Italy and Japan never directly fought alongside nor against anywhere at any point of World War II, so it's not easy to compare their armies, but it is right to consider the Japanese overall the better one. The Italian Navy couldn't defeat the British Navy in the Mediterranean Sea, but it wasn't a pushover either, managing to damage and sink numerous ships. It managed to hold its own also in unconventional ways, like the famous raid on Alexandria, which heavily damaged four British ships, making them sink in shallow water, and gave momentaneous supremacy in the Mediterranean Sea to the Axis Navy. But the Japanese Navy counted huge numbers, the third largest navy of the world at the time, and was definitely the engine of the Japanese war machine. Japan, being an archipelago, of course had its military focus on the Navy and the Air Force, while its land forces were never considered top-notch, even rather below average. The Japanese army didn't even attempt to help the European Axis countries in Operation Barbarossa, invading the Soviet Union from east. Their land forces would have stood no chances against the Red Army, even if outnumbering them. Moreover, the conditions of the roads in East Russia were even worse than the ones in West Russia. The Japanese land forces achieved some victories in East Asian countries against few British Commonwealth, French and Dutch colonial divisions, who were most of the times outnumbered and unable to be properly supported by their motherlands. The Japanese army was also involved in the war against China. The Chinese army was a very large one, but certainly not a modern one, and made up mostly by infantry. The Japanese army was able to conquer a good part of eastern China, but was locked in very long periods of stalemate up until the end of the war. On the other hand, Italian land forces fought the good majority of the war for their country. But here's the big difference that makes it hard to compare the Italian and the Japanese armies in World War II. They fought different enemies in different parts of the world on different terrains. The Italian-led forces had to face a much greater number of armies and soldiers. France, the British Empire, Greece, Yugoslavia, the Soviet Union, the United States, and more. The terrains differed greatly as well, from the North African desert and the East African arid plateaus to the Greek mountains, the Italian hills, the French Alps, and the frozen steppes of Russia. The Japanese land forces, on the other hand, fought against fewer enemies and always in East Asia, which of course had a range of different terrains, but still rather similar to each other: Southeast Asian jungles, marshlands, and plains. The Italian army would have had a hard time fighting there, not having the equipment for those conditions, but in no way the Japanese army could have been effective in North Africa, in the European mountains or the Russian steppes. There were no reasons for Japanese soldiers to be equipped for those types of conditions. The last thing that should be said on a more emotional note is that the Italian army more often than not suffered from very low morale compared to the Japanese army. All in all, I agree that the Japanese army was overall stronger than the Italian one, but not by that much, and both of them being far weaker than the Wehrmacht. The Italian forces had to face a much bigger number of enemies and were not suited to fight in East Asia, just like the Japanese forces weren't suited to fight anywhere else. Mussolini's aim was to recreate the Roman Empire and to rule the Mediterranean Sea. This is a slight misconception. It's not that Mussolini wouldn't have liked to do so, but even he was more realistic than that. People often believe this was the main goal of fascism, but it's not completely correct. Mussolini's goal was to make Italy a dominant force in Europe alongside its allies. Recreating the Roman Empire would suggest that Mussolini believed it was possible for Italy to invade half of Europe, which he knew impossible. Rather, it's more correct to say that Mussolini would have liked to build a fascist empire in Europe, or at least around the Mediterranean Sea, and of course to destroy the capitalist plutocratic British Empire. Maps of the new Roman Empire were drawn by the fascist propaganda, but it was little more than just propaganda. For example, Austria and southern Germany were included in the empire, just like the old Roman Empire, but Mussolini never even dreamt of trying to put those maps into practice. Mussolini knew the formation of a fascist empire required allies with similar ideology, like Hitler's Germany, or the perfect example, Franco's Spain. Italy was the foreign country that most intervened in the Spanish Civil War, helping Franco's rise to power. At the end of the war, Mussolini instructed the Italian troops in Spain to leave plenty of weapons and artillery as a gift to help Franco's Spanish army with its reconstruction after the war. Why would Mussolini, who, according to the fascist propaganda, wanted to annex Spain into his new Roman Empire, leave weapons to the Spanish army? The answer is simple. Mussolini didn't want nor need to actually annex Spain. Spain was already part of the fascist empire he wanted from the moment that Franco won the civil war. The same goes for the independent state of Croatia, which was formed during the Axis invasion of Yugoslavia. It was, just like Spain, a Mediterranean country inside the borders of the old Roman Empire, but Mussolini was completely fine with it, because Croatia was a fascist state as well. On the other hand, the British North Africa and Greece were not fascist countries, rather enemies of fascist Italy. Greece being won by proxy, being neutral in the war, but having good relations with Great Britain. So, rather than to form a new Roman Empire, it's more correct to define Mussolini's goal as to form a European fascist empire with Italy's fascist allies. Germany invaded Italy. This is not a myth, rather a misconception on how the events unfolded. First of all, the expression more widely used is Germany occupied Italy, which is correct. After the Italian armistice of September 1943, Hitler knew he couldn't allow the Allies to take possession of the entirety of Italy and quickly bring the war up to the Austrian border. Therefore, the Germans started Operation Achse, with Wehrmacht troops confronting, both in Italy and abroad, the Italian armed forces. Alongside the few German divisions already in Italy before Operation Achse, the Wehrmacht managed to peacefully disarm the vast majority of the Italian army, which was left without orders by the deafening silence of a king and a marshal busy escaping to the Allied-controlled southern Italy. This played in favor of the Germans, which most of the times didn't have to fight the Italians. After all, it's not surprising that most of the outnumbered, under-equipped and isolated Italian units would peacefully give up their weapons to the Germans, knowing that they could have hardly resisted in battle against them. The soldiers who peacefully surrendered were usually taken to prison camps, where they had the choice of rejoining the war on the Axis side or remaining prisoner. Most of the prisoners chose the second option. Of course, some Italian units chose to immediately side with the Germans, above all the Black Shirts, the fascist elite troops. Almost the totality of them never stopped fighting for the Axis, and at times even helped the Germans disarming other Italian units. We also have some Italian units who refused to comply with the German orders and had to be defeated by the Germans, like the infamous massacred Acqui Division. Last but not least, there were few divisions that remained loyal to the king and managed to get to South Italy to eventually form the Italian co-belligerent army. It's clear to see that the fate of Italian soldiers could differ a lot from one soldier to another. We cannot generalize on what happened. You even had fascists who didn't believe in a victory anymore and reluctantly decided to remain prisoners, as well as soldiers that were not fascist but who decided to keep on fighting for the Germans and the Italian Social Republic, believing that to be a better fate than a prison camp. During Operation Axe, there was no war between Germany and Italy. Italy was a neutral, non-belligerent state by that point, and apart from few clashes caused by the few Italian units who refused to comply, the only actual battle that Italian soldiers fought against Germans was the Battle of Roma. Italian divisions, taken mostly by surprise and left without orders by their officers, tried in vain to defend Roma from the Germans. Calling these events the German occupation of Italy is much more accurate than calling them invasion, as invasion is a word used for the German invasion of France, of Poland or of Belgium. All operations that involved heavy battles and good strategies. The case with Italy is much more similar to what happened with Hungary and in part Slovakia, two other Axis countries that were occupied rather than invaded by Germany to ensure they would remain in the Axis, with relatively little bloodshed. Only later, after the formation of the Italian Social Republic, the violent aspects of an occupation would come, against partisans and innocent civilians. The Allied invasion of Italy was a total success. This is connected to my last point. Often Operation Husky, the Allied invasion of Italy, is considered a great success, but this is not really the case. British Prime Minister Winston Churchill and his generals were big advocates of invading Italy to knock it out of the war and leaving Germany more vulnerable. On the other hand, American President Roosevelt and his generals thought the time was right to attack Germany directly, or at least from German-occupied France. In the end, the British way was taken and the Allies invaded Sicily in July 1943, conquering it in around 1 month. On the 8th of September, Italy officially surrendered and was out of the war. But did the Allies actually obtain what did they expect? Not really. Of course, having Italy out of the war was the main goal, and it was achieved. But the British command thought that the Allies should have been able to quickly take possession of Italy after the armistice, bringing the fight to the Germans, at best in Austria, at worst in North Italy. They were counting on the fact that the air invasion would spell the end of Mussolini's government and that the new leader, who would be Marshal Badoglio and King Vittorio Emanuele III, would quickly side with the Allies, declaring war on Germany and ordering the Italian army to start attacking German positions. Moreover, there was a plan to release a large number of the many Italian prisoners in North Africa to aid the Allies' advance into Italy. But things didn't go this way. Perhaps the Allies underestimated how many Italians, especially certain officers who knew reserved informations, were still loyal to Mussolini, or maybe didn't realize that Badoglio and the king weren't eager to take orders from Anglo-Americans. In any case, after the armistice of the 8th of September, the German advance into central South Italy was quick and rarely opposed. Vast majority of the Italian army was peacefully disarmed, which meant that even though several hundred thousand Italian soldiers were out of the war, their weapons, supplies and equipment were now in German hands. Moreover, the Black Shirts and few other Italian units sided with the Germans. The Allies, which controlled southern Italy at that point, were maybe too slow to react, not expecting that Germans would be able to advance so quickly and easily, to try and put up a front already in central South Italy. Eventually, the proper front would become the Gustav Line in central South Italy, and later the Gothic Line in central North Italy. After Mussolini was freed from imprisonment and created the Italian Social Republic on the 23rd of September, things got even worse for the Allies, with the newly formed Italian state re-entering the war on the German side with the Black Shirts and a new army in the making. This meant that most of the numerous Italian prisoners in North Africa couldn't be released, but had to be kept as prisoners. There was no telling if they would have joined the Italian Social Republic given the chance. So, overall, invading Italy was a success for the Allies, as it knocked out almost an entire army and created a collaborationist government and army, but this was partially compensated by the rapid, almost unopposed German advance into Italy to set up a front against the Allies, the huge amount of weapons and supplies taken from the Italian prisoners of war and the Italian Social Republic forces, which soon resumed the fight for the Axis. A success, but certainly not a total one.
There has been a civil war in Italy.
This is true. Some people don't realize that a civil war started in Italy after the armistice, mainly because they ignore the existence of the Italian Social Republic or just consider the civil war part of the Italian campaign. The latter wouldn't be wrong. But even the ones that do realize often mistakenly believe that the civil war was fought between the Italian Social Republic soldiers and the Italian co-belligerent army, which is not the case. These two armies almost never clashed, one of the very few occasions in which there was a considerable number of their soldiers on both sides of the battle was Operation Herring, in the final days of the Italian Social Republic and the campaign of Italy. Ironically, the soldiers of the Italian co-belligerent army who took part in this operation were the Nembo Regiment, a regiment which was divided between the Italian Social Republic and the Kingdom of Italy right after the armistice. But for the rest, vast majority of the civil war was fought between Italian Social Republic forces and partisans, who outnumbered the Italian co-belligerent forces. The similarity between the Republican army and the co-belligerent army was that both were subordinate armies, respectively to the Wehrmacht and to the Anglo-Americans. But the difference between them was that Germans needed every soldier they could get, they would always put Italian units everywhere, whether on the front lines, alongside other German units, or conducting anti-partisan operations. The co-belligerent army instead saw much less action, as the Allies rarely used Italian units. Moreover, the Italian co-belligerent army was much smaller in size compared to the Italian Social Republic army. Different sources give different sizes, but it's widely established that the co-belligerent army counted between 100,000 and, towards the end of the war, 250,000 soldiers. The Italian Social Republic forces counted between at least 550,000 to at maximum 900,000 soldiers deployed in every European theater, also thanks to the forced conscription in northern Italy. The big Italian resistance movement was the one that mostly brought the fight to the Axis troops in Italy, often clashing against Italian Social Republic or German soldiers. Growing more and more in time, eventually the CLN, Comitato di Liberazione Nazionale, National Liberation Committee, declared a popular insurrection in northern Italy on the 25th of April 1945, which contributed to the fall of the Italian Social Republic. On the 28th of April, while the Axis forces in Italy were fighting their last battles, partisans managed to capture and execute Mussolini, who was trying to escape to Switzerland. By 1943, Mussolini was very unpopular in Italy. A quick point, it's safe to say that by 1943, Mussolini was suffering from low popularity in Italy because of the military defeats. This doesn't mean there weren't people who still supported him or fascism. There will be a considerable number of them until the end of the war, but majority of the Italian population would have liked to see Italy surrender and drop out of the war. In reality, Mussolini himself agreed with that, as he revealed to Francisco Franco in a meeting. He understood the war was lost after the failed Operation Barbarossa, and he would have liked for Italy to surrender, but in no way he could have accepted his country to go under Anglo-American control. What many do not understand is that after the armistice and after the start of the civil war, there were no popular figures in the Italian political scene. Mussolini was seen as an incompetent military leader, and after he became Duce of the Italian Social Republic, many had the feeling that he had become a simple puppet, a shadow of his former self. Anti-fascists hated him, and a number of fascists had doubts on him. On the other hand, King Vittorio Emanuele III and Badoglio weren't popular either, at all. They were seen as people who supported Mussolini's politics as long as the situation wasn't critical for the country, and then they bailed out and jumped ship. After all, Badoglio was a general of the Italian Royal Army under Mussolini, while the king never opposed Mussolini and always seemed compliant with fascist Italy's early successes, gladly calling himself Emperor of the Italian Empire. Immediately after the armistice, the king and Badoglio ran from Roma to the allied occupied southern Italy, leaving the entire Italian army without orders, only to be easily captured and disarmed by the German divisions. Badoglio and the king were seen as opportunistic cowards by most of anti-fascists, even if now they were fighting on the same side. That's a reason why many former soldiers preferred becoming partisans and fight for their ideals themselves, rather than joining the Italian co-belligerent army. Fascists, on the other hand, saw Badoglio and the king as traitors, who betrayed the Italian motherland and the Axis. During the Italian Civil War, there were no popular Italian big political figures, and it's safe to say that, apart from the conscripts, many fascists and partisans fought following their ideals, rather than a leader. The Italian Social Republic was a puppet state. The Italian Social Republic is considered by most historians a puppet state. The definition of a puppet state is: a puppet state, puppet regime, or puppet government is a state that is in theory independent, but in practice completely dependent upon an outside power and subject to its orders. Puppet states have nominal sovereignty, but a foreign power effectively exercises control through means such as financial interests, economic or military support. It is important to specify, though, that the term puppet state is a rather broad term, and there's only a fine line between a puppet state and an allied state that is completely subordinate to another. Mussolini himself stated that he didn't want to be the head of a puppet state, realizing that most of the decisions would have been practically made by Germans, who weren't willing to leave the Italian Republican government effectively rule the country. But there is a reason why some historians consider the Italian Social Republic an insurrectional government, rather than a puppet state. Anglo-American historiography tends to define most countries aligned with the Axis as puppet states, while the same isn't applied for the countries aligned with the Allies that were completely subordinate to them. For example, what remained of the Kingdom of Italy, sometimes referred as the Kingdom of the South, is rarely considered a puppet state, even though it was completely dependent on the Allies, with the only difference being the presence of a king to give the state some sort of legitimacy. The Hellenic state in Greece or Quisling's government in Norway are great examples of collaborationist governments or puppet states. The Italian Social Republic or the independent state of Croatia could be considered puppet states, but they did have some sort of popular support and a proper army. So while considering the Italian Social Republic a puppet state is not wrong, it did have some limited independence, unlike other absolute puppet states. The Italian Social Republic was not allowed to have an army, or the Italian Social Republic army only fought partisans. This is an absolute myth, mainly perpetuated by Anglo-American misconceptions and or revisionism. Not only the Italian Social Republic was allowed to have an army, but it was required to from the Germans. The Axis was losing ground on all fronts, and Germans needed every soldier they could get. In September 1943, after the establishment of the Italian Social Republic, plans to create a military immediately started. The new Italian military was to be subordinate to the Wehrmacht and fight mostly on the Italian front and in the Balkans, but Republican units would be used elsewhere as well. Blackshirts, the fascist elite troops who elected to continue the fight for the Axis, formed the core of the new army. Few rebel units of the disaggregating Royal Italian Army joined as well, and the conscription in the Republican army soon became mandatory in the territory of the Italian Social Republic. There was a death penalty for who refused. The Italian Social Republic forces ended up being quite large, from 550,000 up to 900,000 soldiers estimated, deployed mainly in Italy and Yugoslavia, but several units were present also in France and in Greece, even for Operation Overlord, also known as the Normandy Landings, with the Divisione Atlantica Fucilieri di Marina. Few smaller units fought also in the Eastern Front, like the Battalion 9 Settembre, considered one of the first units of the Republican Army. The Italian Social Republic forces were divided as such: Esercito Nazionale Repubblicano, National Republican Army. It counted around 350,000 soldiers in Italy and numerous divisions abroad. They were the soldiers deployed on the front line in Italy and in every European theater. Very often they were divided into smaller units, always serving alongside German units. The great majority of the new volunteers and conscripts ended up in the National Republican Army. At times they were also deployed for anti-partisan operations, rather than on the front line against the Allies. The Republican Navy Division, Decima Flottiglia Mass, deserves to be mentioned. Considered to be the best division of the Italian Royal Navy, widely known as the one that put the raid on Alexandria into practice, remained on the German side after the armistice, even though few elements defected to the Royal co-belligerent Navy. It was one of the elite divisions of the Italian Social Republic and considered the most independent and less subordinate to the Germans. Guardia Nazionale Repubblicana, National Republican Guard. Sometimes they are mistaken as some sort of fascist police, which is wrong. The fascist police existed and was a completely different thing. These soldiers had an equipment comparable to the one of a proper army, and many of them were former black shirts. While the Republican Army was more like a nation's army, therefore made up by men of different backgrounds and ideologies, the Republican Guard was composed mainly by fascists. The Republican Guard counted 150,000 up to 200,000 soldiers, and they were deployed for anti-partisan operations. At times, units of the Republican Guard were also deployed on the front line against the Allies. There's to be said that by April 1945, in the last days of the Italian Social Republic, there was no more distinction in practice between the army and the guard. Both of them fought against the Allies and the partisans in a last attempt to defend the North Italian cities. These were the two main fighting corps of the RSI, but not the only ones. Brigate Nere, Black Brigades. These cannot be considered regular military, rather paramilitary volunteers. The Black Brigades had some sort of proper infantry equipment, but for the rest, they were poorly equipped and poorly trained, so their effectiveness in battle was limited. The size was actually impressive, more than 100,000 volunteers formed the Black Brigades, but in reality only one-third of them was usually able to fight, simply because there weren't enough weapons, ammunitions and equipment to allow all of them to fight. The Black Brigades used to patrol cities and engage in anti-partisan operations, usually subordinate to the Germans or to the Italian Social Republic military. The numbers of the Black Brigades were high also because they usually accepted people who wouldn't normally be accepted in the Italian army. Women, very young men, very old men, former soldiers who were injured and not in a proper fighting condition, criminals released from prison, and other die-hard fascists that for some reason or another weren't accepted in the military. The Black Brigades were infamous for their violence and their cruelty towards partisans and at times innocent civilians, taking part as main perpetrators or helpers in numerous Axis war crimes. In the last days of the Italian campaign, some brigades even clashed against the invading Allies. The Female Auxiliary Corps. Women weren't allowed to join the military in the Kingdom of Italy, but they could in the Italian Social Republic. Women who wished to fight could either join the Black Brigades, which was paramilitary, not official RSI forces, or the Female Auxiliary Corps. It counted around 6,000 volunteer women, who were for the vast majority auxiliary troops. Only the final days of the invasion, some of them saw the battlefield. After the war, some members of the female auxiliary troops were subject to mockery, rape or murder. Other Italians continued their fight for the Axis but were not part of the Italian Social Republic forces, for example. Italienische Waffengrenadier Division der SS, the Italian Waffen SS. 18,000 soldiers formed the Italian Waffen SS Division, which fought in almost every major clash of the Italian campaign against the Allies, obtaining good results. In late April 1945, it was captured by an American armored division in North Italy. An unprecised number of Italians in the Wehrmacht and International Waffen SS divisions. Most of them were prisoners of war who agreed to resume the fight for the Axis, but it's impossible to know even an approximate number for obvious reasons. It is known that numerous German artillery pieces and machine guns during the Normandy landings were manned by Italians. There's to be said that the Italian Social Republic forces suffered heavy desertions at times by conscripts unwilling to fight or opposed to fascism, who eventually hid in the countryside or joined the partisans. It's not surprising from an Italian point of view, seeing a considerable number of men joining the RSI forces though. While many were conscripts, many others were volunteers. For someone living in the battlefield that Italy was at the time, it wasn't difficult to see Anglo-Americans who were bombing Italian cities as the enemies, rather than the Germans who were trying to stop those bombings. The Italian Social Republic forces' contribution in the Italian campaign is often ignored, and these numbers differ greatly according to the sources for a variety of reasons. The Italian Social Republic archives were in part destroyed by the fascists in the last days of the war, while many former Republican soldiers were able to hide their allegiance after the war to escape imprisonment or execution by either the Allies or the new partisan government. Some elements of the post-war Italian governments also tended to belittle these numbers, to give the impression that only a handful of Italians adhered to the RSI. Anglo-Americans did the same, either voluntarily or not. The Italian Social Republic was not a recognized state by the Allies, which was already a reason to omit references to it in official documents and in popular Anglo-Saxon culture. Moreover, almost all Italian Social Republic units were subordinate to the Germans and always used to serve alongside them. Therefore, it was not easy nor necessary for American or British troops to differentiate between German and Italian units. That is why, at times in the Italian campaign, only Germans are recognized to be fighting on the Axis side, because Anglo-American troops often had no interest nor means to recognize Italian units. Of course, we cannot ignore the part revisionism had in this. American politicians instructed to ignore and keep a certain level of secrecy on the Italians who kept on fighting for the Axis, to have a good base for a post-war alliance, transforming Italy into a NATO ally and an American military outpost. Just like the plan of recognizing Vichy France and not recognizing Free France would have given a good reason to Americans to military administrate France after the war. Anglo-American military officers and historians as well belittled the Italian Social Republic participation and the entire country, as if there weren't more than 1 million Italians fighting on both sides of the Italian campaign. For example, in this article I found, The Gothic Line, How the Allies Breached Germany's Defenses in Italy, written by Michael Heskew for Warfare History Network. A quite long article on the Gothic Line and the various battles of the Italian campaign. Incredibly, in 31 pages, there is not a single mention of the Italian Social Republic, nor of its military, always referring to the Axis troops as Germans. And what is subtle revisionism soon becomes straight-up lying in the Operation Winter Thunderstorm chapter. The Operation Winter Thunderstorm, also known as Battle of Garfagnana, was a small but successful Axis counter-offensive in central North Italy against mostly American troops in December 1944. It is known for being one of the very few battles in which Italian Social Republic soldiers outnumbered the German soldiers, 3/4 of the Axis troops were Italian, and for being the final Axis counter-offensive of the Italian front. From that moment on, the Axis was able to achieve only defensive victories in Italy. It's actually hilarious to see how the author continues to call the Axis soldiers that took part in that operation Germans, and even mentions exclusively the German units out of the Axis battle order. Elements of the German 285th and 286th Infantry Regiments, the 4th Alpine Battalion and the Mittenwald Battalion advanced up to 5 miles, capturing several villages and putting many soldiers of the 92nd Division to flight. Now let's take a look at the Axis order of battle for that operation. The 285th Infantry Regiment, the 4th Alpine Battalion and Mittenwald Battalion. Coincidentally, all Italian forces who made up the majority of the Axis troops in this operation are not mentioned. Two Alpini battalions and a unit of the Monte Rosa Division and a battalion of the San Marco Division. To make matters even more ridiculous, the author writes on how the American 92nd Division, which was the defensive side of this counterattack, was inexperienced. He completely fails to mention how, in reality, the Axis was in a disadvantaged position, counting half the men of the Allies' divisions, less artillery and no tanks. In the Italian campaign, Italian Social Republic units fought in almost every battle, from the Battle of Anzio against the Anglo-American troops, to the countless and successful defensive battles on the Gothic Line. Let's not forget the many defensive battles at the Italian borders as well, in the northwest against Free French troops and in the northeast against the advancing Yugoslav Liberation Army of Tito. Last but not least, the chaos of late April 1945, when the partisan-driven popular insurrection and the Allies' breach of the Gothic Line 1939 transformed almost every North Italian city in a battlefield. Italian Social Republic forces even took part in sabotages in the territory of the Allies-controlled Kingdom of Italy. In Sant'Angelo in Formis, there's a memorial for the fallen soldiers of the RSI, captured and executed by the Allies for their acts of sabotage. It reads, "In the gigantic fight of blood against gold, here between January and May 1944, for the vision of a greater Italy in a united Europe, fell these young RSI soldiers, executed by the Anglo-American invaders." This is a proof of the Italian Social Republic action even in the Allies-controlled territories, as Sant'Angelo in Formis was part of the Allied-controlled Kingdom of Italy at the time, and it sums up the original ideals of fascism quite well. Abroad, Italian Social Republic soldiers were heavily used by the Germans in Yugoslavia, but also Greece and France, even in Normandy, with a few small units on the Eastern Front too. After the fall of the Italian Social Republic, few Republican army units were left stranded in Austria, one of the few remaining Axis territories. At the end of the war in Europe, some of these soldiers would never make return to Italy, to avoid trials and executions. Some fascists managed to escape to Franco's Spain. Many of those who remained in Italy were put on trial by partisans and the Allies, for war crimes or for simply disobeying royal orders. General Tito Agosti took his own life in an American prison camp in 1946, stating, "I will not allow a bunch of traitors to put me on trial." Sometimes summary executions would take the place of trials, especially when conducted by partisans and especially when regarding former RSI soldiers who never surrendered themselves to the Allies. In the end, Italian Social Republic soldiers, like their German allies, were on the wrong side of history. No one denies, or at least no one should deny, the atrocities that they committed. But deleting their memory from history, like every revisionism, is a crime against history itself. The Italian army never won major battles or never conducted successful campaigns. This is another myth perpetuated by ignorant and revisionists. Granted, overall World War II was a disaster for Italy, and failures clearly outnumber successes, but this doesn't mean the Italian military never managed to valiantly fight in certain battles and conduct successful operations. If we were to count every single Italian success in every small clash against enemy armies, we would never finish, so I will list few notable instances in which the Italian forces were successful. In the North African campaign, even though Italians were heavily defeated by the British Operation Compass, they still managed to obtain few victories. The quick invasion of Egypt was successful, but the outnumbered British troops mostly retreated, so it's hardly a notable success. During Operation Compass, the Italian army was only able to at best slow down the mechanized British divisions. But when the Germans intervened and began Operation Sonnenblume in early 1941, the Italian troops in North Africa started performing much better, perhaps having more faith in Erwin Rommel than in the usually incompetent Italian officers. The Axis troops, composed mostly by Italians but under German command, pushed the British out of Libya, back at the Egyptian border. In the subsequent offensives and counter-offensives, in which the Axis forces were usually outnumbered, the Italian troops under German command achieved good results. In 1941, the Allies failed Operation Brevity in May and Operation Battleaxe in June, two counter-offensives aimed at pushing the Axis back into Libya. In November 1941, finally the British obtained their first success against the German army in World War II, Operation Crusader, which managed to push the Axis back west, for a time at least. But not every battle of Operation Crusader resulted in an Allied victory. The British Commonwealth forces lost two battles in Bir el Gobi. The first battle was fought in November 1941 between British armored brigades, counting 150 tanks, and Italian armored division Ariete, one of the best divisions of the Italian army, counting 130 tanks. The British maybe underestimated the Ariete division, who instead defended Bir el Gobi effectively. Few days later, the Ariete division and Italian infantry troops captured a large number of British Commonwealth troops during the counterattack. New Zealander officer Howard Kippenberger had to say about the Ariete division, "About 5:30 p.m., damned Italian motorized division turned up. They passed with 5 tanks leading, 20 following, and a huge column of transport and guns, and rolled straight over our infantry on point 175.
In December, the British tried again at Birel Gobi, failing again, with the Italian defenders, later reinforced by German forces, managing to hold their position once again. The British troops, heavily outnumbering the Italians, were stopped by the Blackshirts battalion Giovani Fascisti, made up by very young soldiers who successfully defended Birel Gobi once again. Although General Norris had an overwhelming superiority in every arm in the area of Birel Gobi, the failure to concentrate them and coordinate the action of all arms in detail had allowed one Italian battalion group to frustrate the action of his whole corps and inflict heavy casualties on one brigade. Giovani Fascisti made their mark during Operation Crusader. Tasked to defend the small hill known as Bir el Gobi, they fought off repeated attacks by the 11th Indian Brigade and British 7th Armored Division during the first week of December 1941. Despite overwhelming odds, they inflicted massive casualties on the Allies and held their ground despite severe hunger and thirst. This battle was the perfect example of the usefulness of the often mocked Italian L3 tankettes. They managed to inflict serious casualties to the British infantry, thanks to the machine gun mounted on them, but were later destroyed by British tanks, proving themselves useless against armored divisions. In May 1942, the Battle of Ain el Ghazala was a devastating defeat for the Allies. Even when outnumbered, the Axis forces, which were composed by two-thirds of Italian divisions, inflicted massive damage. Out of 110,000 Allied soldiers, 50,000 would be either killed, wounded or captured, compared to the 6,000 lost soldiers on the Axis side. The same repeated in the smaller tank battle of Mersa Matruh in June, in which 100 German and Italian tanks defeated 200 British tanks. These victories boosted the morale of the Italian troops serving under Rommel. In September 1942, the British launched a small amphibious operation agreement, attacking the Axis naval base near Tobruk. It was a complete disaster for the Allies, who, even when outnumbering the Italian troops stationed there, suffered massive losses. Vast majority of British and Commonwealth soldiers were killed or captured, compared to almost no casualties on the Axis side. The First and the Second Battle of El Alamein, respectively July 1942 and October 1942, resulted in Axis defeats, but Italian troops fought bravely in both cases. After the First Battle of El Alamein, Erwin Rommel stated, "The Italian was willing, unselfish and a good comrade, and considering the conditions under which he served, had always given better than average." The Second Battle of El Alamein was tragic for the Italian divisions which took part in it. Italian artillery inflicted heavy losses on the British armored divisions, destroying many tanks. Eventually out of ammunition and out of fuel for their anyway few vehicles, most Italian troops found themselves stranded in the desert, with German divisions mostly able to retreat with the little fuel and the little vehicles they had left. Italian soldiers had to sacrifice themselves to cover the retreat of who could actually retreat. Here was where the Italian Ariete Armored Division met its end, resisting until complete destruction while heavily outnumbered. The infamous last radio message was: "Enemy tanks penetrated south of Ariete. Ariete now encircled. Location 5 km northwest Bir el Abd. Ariete tanks fight on." Erwin Rommel, who managed to successfully retreat, stated, "The Italians, who at the time represented our strongest motorized force, fought with exemplary courage. Tank after tank split asunder or burnt out, while all the time a tremendous British barrage lay over the Italian infantry and artillery positions. In the Ariete we lost our oldest Italian comrades, from whom we had probably always demanded more than they, with their poor armament, had been capable of performing." The Italian infantry units who weren't able to retreat either surrendered, perished in combat, or fought their way out to attempt an improbable retreat by foot through the desert. British armored divisions later caught up with the survivors and captured them. Colonel Arrigo Dall'Olio of the Bologna Regiment told the British, "We have ceased firing not because we haven't the desire, but because we have spent every round." In a final act of defiance, the survivor soldiers of the Bologna Regiment refused to raise their hands. In the East African campaign, Italians met with less success. In August 1940, Italian and Eritrean troops, outnumbering their enemies, conquered the small British Somalia. In January 1941, Colonel Amedeo Goulet attacked a British and Indian armored division camp with his Eritrean cavalry, using swords, guns and hand grenades. The British, taken by surprise and disoriented by this mad maneuver, were slow to react and couldn't quickly set their tanks into action. Amedeo Goulet, nicknamed Devil Commander, managed to destroy several tanks and artillery pieces with a heavy human cost. This will be the last cavalry charge ever faced by the British Empire. Even after the capitulation of Italian forces in East Africa, Colonel Guillet will continue the fight against the Allies with guerrilla warfare up until the armistice. In Greece and in France, Italian troops didn't obtain particular victories, apart from initial pushes and few defensive successes, common in every campaign, especially against the Free French troops towards the end of the war on the Italian border. Charles de Gaulle would have liked the idea of a French Valle d'Aosta, but Italian Social Republic divisions successfully kept Free French troops out of the region before the final surrender, therefore preventing any French claim on Valle d'Aosta after the war. In France, Italian Social Republic soldiers fought on the defensive in Normandy and resisted for a long time in a small fort on the Sesembre island. The invasion of Yugoslavia, instead, was probably the most successful Italian campaign of World War II. In April 1941, the Axis opted for an invasion of Yugoslavia. The German, Italian and Hungarian militaries took part in the invasion. From the very beginning of the invasion, the Yugoslav situation was already desperate, since the country was almost completely surrounded by invading Axis troops. German, Italian and Hungarian soldiers attacked from the north, pouring into today's Slovenia. German troops were also attacking from Bulgaria and Romania, and conducted bombings on the capital city Beograd, while Italian troops were ready to attack from Zara, today the Croatian city of Zadar, at the time Italian territory, and from North Albania. The Yugoslav command knew the army wasn't prepared and well equipped enough to face such an invasion on all fronts, so a difficult decision was made. Slovenia and Croatia, the north of the country, were to be abandoned and left to the Axis, except from few sacrificial units. The desperate and improbable plan was to attack the Italian forces in the south of the country. By penetrating into Albania and completely defeating all Italian divisions stationed there, possibly with some help from the Greek army, the Yugoslav command hoped to form a common front with the Greeks, the Yugoslav and the Greek army in the south against the invading Axis troops in the north. They knew that they stood more chances against the under-equipped Italian Royal Army than against the Wehrmacht. Therefore, the bulk of the army was moved south, while few units were sacrificed elsewhere in an attempt to slow down the invaders. But the Yugoslav plan proved itself way too ambitious. Even when outnumbering Italian troops, their equipment was worse and they were not as motorized. Therefore, the Yugoslav army wasn't able to defeat the Italians stationed in Zara, while the penetration into Albania was successful for only few kilometers. They were stopped at the first proper battle by the armored division Centauro, considered one of the best of the Italian army during World War II, which also led the counter-offensive and pushed the Yugoslav troops outside of Albania. Italian intelligence also managed to crack Yugoslav codes and prevented Yugoslav divisions to properly communicate with each other or with their Greek allies. On the west coast and at the Albanian border, the biggest and bloodiest battles of the invasion of Yugoslavia took place between the Royal Yugoslav Army and the Royal Italian Army. While in the north of the country, cities like Ljubljana and Zagreb were being taken by almost unopposed Axis divisions, the Italian troops attacking from Zara managed to capture Split after heavy resistance from Yugoslav divisions. With the attack failed, the Yugoslav army was retreating and on the defensive. Italian troops slowly advanced among heavy fighting until the German divisions arrived and quickly put an end to the courageous but overwhelmed Yugoslav resistance. In 1944 and 1945, with the Axis retreating from every front, Italian Social Republic units fought various battles in today's Slovenia against Tito's Yugoslav Liberation Army, which was trying to advance into Italian territory as much as possible to be able to revendicate it after the war. The Italian Social Republic units were able to slow down the Yugoslav advance, but not to stop it. Operation Barbarossa, the invasion of the Soviet Union, was a disaster for the Italian army, but nonetheless, Italian divisions achieved few victories. Apart from the initial push, in which the Axis obtained heavy victories on the Red Army, and few other successful operations alongside their Axis allies, Italian divisions were successful by themselves as well. In the first defensive battle of the Don in August 1942, the outnumbered Italian troops were able to repel continuous Soviet attacks. More than one battle, as the name suggests, it was a series of battles that spanned for 11 days. In those days, something that is remembered as one of the last significant cavalry charges in history took place, the charge of Izbushensky. As one Soviet regiment was getting ready to attack the Savoia Cavalry Regiment's camp, a small Italian patrolling force blew their cover. Colonel Betoni Cazzago, commander of the Savoia Cavalry Regiment, gives the order for a charge. 700 horsemen of the Savoya Regiment charged the 2,500 Soviet infantrymen using swords, guns and hand grenades in a successful battle. The much larger second defensive battle of the Don of December 1942 instead won't be as lucky for the Italian 8th Army. From here the tragic retreat I talked about in one of the previous points. The Alpini Division Tridentina would attempt to retreat, leading a huge column of Axis soldiers from many different divisions and different nationalities throughout the frozen Russian steppes. Only a fraction of the Axis soldiers were in fighting conditions, and the Italian Alpini Division had to be the one leading all the battles against encircling Soviet units, which were attempting to stop the Axis retreat. After 25 battles in 9 days of marching, the Alpini were successful in defeating the Soviet forces for the last time at the Battle of Nikolayevka, managing to bring home foreign units as well, but after enormous losses. In the Mediterranean Sea, the Italian Navy clashed many times against the British Royal Navy, and only few of them were equipped with radar or sonar devices, unlike the enemy ships. Even though most of the times it wasn't able to defeat the British Navy in battle, the Italian Navy was able to sink and damage various British ships, and conduct numerous successful operations stalling, delaying, and hindering British plans. Among the successes, the First Battle of Sirte in December 1941 and the Battle of Pantelleria in June 1942. The most famous success of the Italian Navy was without a doubt the peculiar raid on Alexandria in December 1941. This action was carried on by one of the best units of the entire Italian military, the Decima Flotilla Mass. 6 divers used manned torpedoes and attacked British ships in the harbor of Alexandria of Egypt. The targets were 2 battleships, 1 tanker and 1 destroyer. The divers successfully attached the magnetic mines to the ships. The explosions severely damaged all of them. The battleship Queen Elizabeth was out of action for 9 months, the battleship Valiant for 6 months. The destroyer Jarvis was the luckiest one, being out of action for only 1 month, while the tanker Sargona was lost and never used again during World War II. Moreover, 8 crew members of the battleship Queen Elizabeth were killed. The British Royal Navy tried to hide the magnitude of the damage, stating that the ships didn't sink but were just badly damaged, something that is carried on today by British historiography. Instead, the ships did sink, but in the shallow waters of the harbor of Alexandria, therefore they weren't completely submerged. The operation, considering the low cost of the manned torpedoes and the huge amount of damage dealt to the British ships, was a great success, even though the 6 Italian divers were eventually captured. Without those 2 battleships, the Axis gained a temporary naval supremacy in that part of the Mediterranean Sea. Last but not least, the Italian campaign. Other than few battles in the northwest against Free French troops and in the northeast against the Yugoslav Liberation Army, Italian forces mostly fought against Anglo-Americans advancing from south. The Italian Royal Army wasn't able to stop the Anglo-American conquest of Sicily, and from then on, the Italian Social Republic Army would be the one fighting alongside the Germans against the Allies. For most of the Italian campaign, Axis troops were outnumbered and less equipped compared to the invading Allies, but nonetheless put on a valiant effort. The Battle of Anzio, south of Roma, lasted for more than 5 months, beginning in January 1944, in which outnumbered Axis divisions tried to contain the Allies before having to retreat north. The Italian Social Republic presence wasn't very big though, around 1/5 of the Axis order of battle. The Battle of Firenze in August 1944 saw Anglo-American troops liberating the city of Firenze from Axis control, with a good help from Italian partisans. Even though the Axis forces defending the city were heavily outnumbered by the Allies, the battle lasted for 1 month. The German and Italian soldiers were able to use their positions effectively, slowly retreating and delaying the Allied advance. Numerous snipers, nicknamed Tiratori Franchi, often hid in houses and stayed behind to cover the retreat of Axis units, fighting road after road and inflicting relatively heavy casualties on the British troops in Firenze, furtherly delaying them. The British officers, losing men and unable to draw out the RSI snipers, ordered to bomb houses with artillery, with devastating results. The Battle of Garfagnana of December 1944, also called Operation Winterstorm or Unternehmen Wintergewitter, saw Italian Social Republic troops compose the majority of the Axis soldiers in the last Axis counteroffensive of the Italian front. The Italian-German side was outnumbered both in men, 9,000 against 18,000, and in artillery. Aimed against American and Indian troops, the operation was nonetheless a success, managing to push the Allies back. It was more of a morale boost for Axis troops, rather than an important strategic victory, with fascist propaganda using this victory as proof that the war could have still been won. For the rest, Italian Social Republic units of the National Republican Army were always mixed with German units in the defense of the Gothic Line. The Gothic Line was an Axis fortified defensive line in the mountains of central North Italy, which lasted between August 1944 to April 1945. The Allies attempted to breach the Gothic Line countless times in a long series of small clashes and few bigger operations. Even the attempts that managed to breach the defense line often didn't lead anywhere and the front line stood still. In these many unnamed clashes, outnumbered and under-equipped Italian Social Republic soldiers fought alongside the Wehrmacht against the Allies, contributing to the survival of the Gothic Line for several months. In the last days of the campaign of Italy, with the final breach of the Gothic Line and the partisan insurrection in North Italy, Italian Social Republic divisions fought in every major Italian city. At times, RSI units that couldn't surrender to the Allies, but were instead fighting partisans or the Yugoslav army, fought to the last man, aware there wouldn't have been imprisonment for them, most likely just an execution. Overall, Italy helped more the Allies than the Axis. This is quite a ridiculous hypothesis, wrong under many aspects. In no way, shape or form can a country, or an army, fighting for one side of the war be an advantage for the other side. It's fair to say that the Italian World War II campaign was close to disastrous, only few operations being successful, but the sheer amount of soldiers, ammunition, vehicles, supplies and equipment thrown into battle by the Italian army heavily outweighs any failure. Many people don't realize that Italian troops supported German troops on every single European and African theater, sometimes making up even the majority of the Axis order of battle, like in North Africa or at times in the Balkans. If we follow this logic, we should also say that the Hungarian army helped the Allies because it was unprepared for Operation Barbarossa, or that Japan did the same by attacking Pearl Harbor, or that Germany did it by opening an Eastern Front. All of these are ridiculous suggestions. One mistake or multiple mistakes cannot be compared to the amount of battles and effort spent on one side of the war. Even if this is a reference to the Kingdom of Italy declaring war on Germany in October 1943, it still wouldn't make sense. The pro-Axis Italian Social Republic forces heavily outnumber the pro-Allies co-belligerent forces, and so the front lines much more often. I do not count partisans in this equation, because although they were numerous and helped the Allies multiple times, they were not regular soldiers, but rebels, civilians who had their own ideals and the right to fight for whoever they wanted. If we were to count World War II battles involving Italian regular soldiers, I would say we end up approximately with 95% of the times with Italian soldiers only on the Axis side, 4% of the times with Italian soldiers on both sides, and 1% of the times with Italian soldiers only on the Allies side. Moreover, there was a big involuntary help from the Italian military to the Germans. During Operation Achse, in which the Wehrmacht started disarming Italian divisions after the armistice, vast majority of the Italian units surrendered peacefully, giving up their weapons, ammunition, equipment, supplies and sometimes vehicles to the Germans, who were able to reuse them in future battles. Even King Vittorio Emanuele III and Marshal Badoglio involuntarily helped the Germans by stalling the Allies with their unwillingness to follow their orders and declare war on Germany right after the armistice. The Italian co-belligerent army and especially the brave resistance had their important part in the liberation of Italy. Nobody can deny that, but in no way that can be compared to the countless battles and campaigns the Kingdom of Italy and then the Italian Social Republic took part on the Axis side. It is wrong to say that, not only because it's revisionism and therefore false, but also because it's an insult to the memory of all soldiers and civilians who were victims of the battles and the invasions in which Italy took part. The Italian Social Republic fell on the 25th of April 1945. It's a small misconception, so I'll say this just to be precise. On the 25th of April 1945, the Italian resistance movement proclaims a popular insurrection in North Italy against the Italian Social Republic fascist regime and German forces. This, combined with the final breach of the Gothic Line by the Allies, led to the downfall of the Italian Social Republic and the end of the war in Italy. But on the 25th of April, the 26th of April and the following days, the Italian Social Republic was still standing and there were battles erupting in many North Italian cities. On the 25th of April, the insurrection started, but battles were fought for several days. The surrender of Caserta, signed on the 29th of April and operative from the 2nd of May 1945, was the actual end of the RSI. The Italian Social Republic surrender was delegated by Marshal Rodolfo Graziani, briefly took Mussolini's place after his death, to a German representative, since the Italian Social Republic wasn't a recognized state by the Allies. The last Italian Social Republic and German units are believed to have surrendered in the first days of May 1945. Every year in Italy, the 25th of April is celebrated as Liberation Day, to commemorate the defeat of Nazi and fascist forces, but the date chosen is purely symbolic. Fascism in Italy died in 1945. This is closer to a personal opinion rather than a historical fact. In Germany, in Austria, and in other countries, Nazi memorabilia, symbols, and salutes are strictly forbidden. Displaying what in Italy is called the Roman salute can be punished by months of jail time in Germany, for example. In Italy, this is not the case. One of the first articles of the post-war Italian constitution forbids anyone from attempting to recreate a fascist party. But for the rest, appreciation of fascism is quite a grey area in Italy. It surely is not well looked upon, but is often considered free speech rather than apology of fascism. Shops selling fascist and even Nazi memorabilia are not impossible to find, and the Roman salute is ignored by many, especially because of its supposedly Roman origins. So here comes the question, did fascism in Italy die in 1945? My answer is yes, the fascist ideology in Italy almost totally died in 1945 or soon after, but people's appreciation of Mussolini lives to this day. Although the obvious minority, it's not rare at all to find someone who defines himself a fan of Mussolini in modern-day Italy. I will explain the differentiation I make. With the fall of the Italian Social Republic in the spring of 1945, fascism ideology mostly perished in Italy. Even though the Italian constitution forbids the re-establishment of a fascist party, nationalist groups inspired to fascism didn't take long to reappear in the Italian political scene. Some were crossing the line and were not accepted as actual parties, some instead were just moderate enough to be voted for. But what really makes me say that these groups that emerged in Italy after World War II were and still are not fascist is the difference of ideals and views they have compared to the National Fascist Party of the 20s. For example, Italy was a founding member of NATO, the North Atlantic Alliance, therefore being immediately drafted into the Cold War. The few fascist remnants of the late 40s and 50s and maybe 60s criticized this move. Fascism, after all, was both anti-communist and anti-capitalist, so aligning with either the Soviet Union or the United States was against fascist ideals. But as I said, this applied only to few remnants units with fascist ideals. Most of the people and the groups who winked at fascism and at Mussolini's legacy, I'll call them neo-fascist for a lack of better term, and the legal far right happily accepted an alliance with Anglo-Americans, seeing the communist Soviet Union as the real enemies and not obstructing the construction of American military bases in Italy. An alliance with Great Britain and the United States, the capitalist plutocratic Freemason enemies hated by fascism, seen as the worst betrayal by fascists a few years prior. The only anti-American view that remained was the disapproval of their collaboration with the Sicilian Mafia during the invasion of Italy. The fascist state, an enemy of Mafia and Freemasonry, was able to get rid of them for the most part because of its censorship and its removal of the right of assembly. During fascist Italy, Sicilian Mafia was in heavy decline, while the biggest Freemason lobby, named Propaganda, was disbanded and some of its members emigrated to France. Of course, this doesn't mean all prisoners of the fascist regime were legitimate. There were plenty of innocent political dissidents. But with the Allied invasion of Sicily, the American command thought it would be a good idea to free most of the prisoners from the local jails and work with them, even giving political roles to few mafia elements, counting on their anti-fascism. It's clear that once the war was over, southern Italy counted a heavy mafia presence once again, while the old Propaganda Freemason lobby was reformed as Propaganda 2, commonly known as P2. Both of them would have a huge impact on Italy's politics for decades. But this was just a drop in the ocean. The more years passed, the more the so-called neo-fascists turned into generic right-wing American sympathizer nationalists. It is sad to see how historical figures' views and actions are arbitrarily changed or omitted to fit a certain type of presentation, to revision history or to create a cult of personality. For example, Mahatma Gandhi had words of appreciation of Mussolini's politics.
Albert Einstein is remembered for being, other than a great physicist, a pacifist, yet he helped in the development of the first nuclear bomb. Beloved writers H.P. Lovecraft and Rudyard Kipling had incredibly racist views. Lovecraft and Kipling seem to suggest that Anglo-Saxons were a much superior race compared to the rest of the world. And what goes for people also goes for ideologies and events. At times in Italy, and much more often abroad, especially in Anglo-Saxon countries, the term fascist is synonym for a right-wing nationalist, for example a supporter of the American Republican Party. An original fascist from the 20s Italy would be an enemy of any political party in the United States. Considering that fascism was slightly anti-American, anti-democratic, and especially anti-capitalist. It is not enough to be nationalist to be considered fascist. Joseph Stalin was a nationalist, Franklin Roosevelt was a nationalist, Winston Churchill was a nationalist and a right-wing conservative, but nobody could ever possibly call them fascists. In modern days, with a good dose of arrogance, it is usually perceived in the United States that fascists were or are capitalists and supporters of former President Donald Trump. In Italy, almost never you hear the term fascist in relation to Donald Trump, probably because the general knowledge of fascism in Italy, being its birthplace, is far superior to the one in America. On the other hand, at times you hear right-wing Americans referring to fascists as socialists, because they are also called national socialists. Yet fascists despised socialism as well, because they were advocating for class wars. The truth is, fascism in Italy is considered far-right, but not capitalist. The mistake is to restrict the political spectrum to a simplistic right-wing capitalism and left-wing socialism.
Capitalist advocates for free market and no intervention from the state in the national economy. Fascist Italy could never be considered capitalist, because in the 30s majority of companies were associated with or owned by the state. As a matter of fact, the only European country with an economy even more in the hands of the state was the Soviet Union.
One can debate how true they were to their words, but fascists labeled their ideology as an alternative to capitalism and socialism. This has been partially forgotten in Italy too, though. There are quite some politicians or groups that are labeled or self-labeled neo-fascist that have very little to do with Mussolini or real fascism. Their supporters might hail to Benito Mussolini, but are too ignorant about his ideals. People like Matteo Salvini or groups like Casa Pound, for example. They like to declare themselves defenders of Italy, when in reality all they do is whining about the European Union, while supporting and adoring people like Donald Trump, as they are right-wing capitalists. Especially people like Salvini, who tried for years and years to have his fictitious region of Padania secede from Italy. The fascist memorial I've read in a previous point says, "In the gigantic fight of blood against gold, here between January and May 1944, for the vision of a greater Italy in a united Europe, fell these young RSI soldiers, executed by the Anglo-American invaders." This is a good example of original fascist views, almost the opposite of what today's neo-fascists support. It is normal that an ideology evolves and modifies itself through time. But from here to supporting views that would have been absolutely against the same ideology in the past, it's a bit too much. World War I Italy was stronger than World War II Italy, or World War I Germany was stronger than World War II Italy. A laughable statement. No World War I army can be compared to any World War II army. The motorization, the technologic superiority of equipment and devices, and the better weapons, vehicles, planes, ships and tanks of World War II armies, which would sign the birth of more modern tactics and make trench warfare obsolete, makes this comparison ridiculous. Unless we are talking about a very big World War I army like the German one, against a very small World War II army like the Danish one, in this case the sheer number of German soldiers would probably prove too much for the Danish World War II army to handle, even because the Danish army was certainly not an advanced one and vastly unprepared for World War II. But when we talk about two big countries like Germany and Italy, this comparison makes no sense. The people who advocate for the idea that the World War II Italian army could have been defeated by any World War I army would be the same people who thought that the Maginot Line would have been effective in World War II and would have been responsible for disastrous military defeats. As the Battle of France and the North African Campaign taught, large infantries didn't stand a chance against motorized armored units. Those infantries had World War II equipment and were supported by World War II vehicles and motorized units. World War I infantry units couldn't even count on them in a hypothetical anachronistic fight against a World War II army. Let's go with order. World War I Italy against World War II Italy. The World War II Italian army was far, far, far stronger than the World War II Italian army, if compared directly. The opposite would be absurd. Why and how could the World War II Italian army be weaker? In 20 years, technology advanced and warfare changed. Modern tanks, modern planes, better artillery, better weapons. Few World War II armored divisions could defeat a whole World War I army, battle after battle. With that out of the way, what about this more sensible statement? World War I Italy performed better than World War II Italy. Which means that, compared to other armies of its time, the Italian army was stronger in World War I than it was in World War II. One could be led to think this, after all, Italy won World War I but lost World War II. But my answer is still a no, for a very simple reason. The magnitude of enemies that Italy faced in World War I is a fraction of what Italy faced in World War II. Let's take a look at the enemies that Italy had to fight against in both World Wars. I will divide them in major enemies and minor enemies, according to the number of battles and amount of resources spent to fight them. In World War I, Italy's major enemies were Austria-Hungary, and that's it. World War I was simply a war against Austria-Hungary for Italy to gain the territories nationalist irredentists wanted. Austria-Hungary, even though it was a relatively large country, was a decaying empire with an outdated and overstretched military, something that even their German allies were well aware of. Minor enemies of Italy in World War I were the German Empire, the Ottoman Empire, and Bulgaria. The Italian army fought more rarely against these armies, and it was always in the modality of small Italian units giving their support in a very international order of battle against the Triple Alliance countries. It's not rare to find small Italian units in battles far away from Italy, but as stated, just small units. What about World War II instead? Italy's major enemies in World War II were the British Empire and Commonwealth, Greece, Yugoslavia, the Soviet Union, and the United States. Minor enemies were France, which I will put among the minor enemies as their battles against the Italian Royal Army or the Italian Social Republic Army weren't many nor very big. And since I put Bulgaria among the minor enemies in World War I, I'd say it's fair to put at least Poland and Brazil in this section of World War II. Polish and Brazilian forces aided the Anglo-American allies in the invasion of Italy, among other smaller forces. So, as you can see, the forces Italy had to face in World War II were incredibly superior to the ones it had to face in World War I, in which the Kingdom of Italy was barely able to defeat Austria-Hungary. So my answer is no. World War II Italian military was of course better than World War I Italian military in a direct comparison, but also better in a comparison in relation to its enemies. Without a doubt, the comparison with the German World War I army would be closer. I could understand the elite World War I German divisions giving a hard time to the lower, under-equipped Italian World War II infantry. But what could the World War I German army, an army composed almost entirely of infantry, do against World War II Italian artillery and motorized armor divisions? The answer is nothing. For the same reason why Italian infantry was powerless against British armor divisions in North Africa, with the difference being even bigger in this case. The Italian army in World War II wasn't as motorized as the German or the British army, but still much, much more motorized than any World War I army, whose level of motorization was almost insignificant. The difference between the navies and air forces would be huge as well. Suggesting that the World War I German army would be better than the World War II Italian army would be suggesting that the World War I German army could have defeated the World War II British army in several battles, which is preposterous. These are ridiculous suggestions. The contest wouldn't even be close. Winston Churchill's quote. For the final point of the video, I'd like to talk about Winston Churchill's clearly revisionist quote on Italians. Bizarre people, Italians. One day 45 million fascists, the next day 45 million between anti-fascists and partisans. Yet these 90 million Italians are not from the census. In this quote, Churchill shows his despise for Italians, trying to tell a story that not only is historically inaccurate, but even makes no sense.
Churchill refers to 45 million fascists, implying that the totality of Italians supported the fascist party. Even if we give some room to generalization, therefore ignoring the millions and millions of women and children who had no right to vote in the Kingdom of Italy, this would imply that the Italian regime wasn't actually a dictatorship, and that there weren't many political prisoners in Italian jails, nor censorship. Moreover, it would imply that there were no Italians who were neutral towards fascism, which actually represented a huge chunk of the Italian population. This counts towards every country involved in World War II, but actually any regime in history. Especially in the past, millions of people weren't interested in politics. They had to work hard to make a living, and some of them didn't even receive proper education. Maybe foreigners could have had this impression in the 30s, considering virtually all medias and newspapers were in the hands of the fascist regime, which never had to face public criticism. With a little dose of self-doubt and humility, it wouldn't be hard to imagine this scenario, but these are qualities Churchill never really showed. But let's pretend it's a figure of speech and move on. According to Churchill, from one day to another, almost all Italians passed from being fascist to anti-fascist. Which day does Churchill mean then? Let's list some options. 25th of July 1943, the fall of fascism. Mussolini is deposed, the army goes into standby and only takes part in defensive operations. Marshal Badoglio, who took Mussolini's place, and King Vittorio Emanuele III state they'll continue the war alongside Germany, while in reality preparing for the Italian surrender. It's a change of leadership, while many soldiers, especially the black shirts, still supported fascism or were anyway pro-Axis. I don't see how this option could make sense. 8th of September 1943, the Italian surrender. After the armistice, the Kingdom of Italy became a neutral state. On the 9th of September, no Italians were fighting under Allied orders. Most of the Italian divisions were being peacefully disarmed by the Germans. Some Italian units immediately sided with the Germans, while some other Italian units refused to obey German orders and were forcefully disarmed. This option makes no sense. It would take a long time for any of these Italians to start acting as actual anti-fascists. 13th of October 1943, the Kingdom of Italy declares war on Germany. Finally, Badoglio and the King accepted the Allies' demands and rejoined the war on the Allies' side after more than 1 month of neutrality. This is hardly from one day to another. Moreover, this completely and willingly ignores the Italian Social Republic, which was formed on the 23rd of September 1943, after Mussolini was freed in the Gran Sasso raid. By the 13th of October, this new Italian state already rejoined the war on the German side and was reforming an army, which at the time was based on the black shirts. The black shirts, alongside few Italian royal units, refused the surrender, seeing it as a betrayal, and sided with the Germans and Mussolini to continue the war. This began the so-called Italian Civil War, the Italian Social Republic forces on one side, partisans and Italian co-belligerent army on the other. Clearly, many fascists were still around at that time. If all Italians, or even remotely close to all, agreed on being anti-fascist, there would have been no civil war. This option makes even less sense than the others. 25th of April 1945, or alternatively, the end of the war. Maybe Churchill meant the fall of the Italian Social Republic. It's true that a good number of former fascist soldiers lied after the war. They declared that they never actually supported Mussolini, but only executed his orders, or they declared to have been German prisoners for a long time, or even anti-fascist partisans. The reason for that is very simple. Immediately after the war, the new partisan government and the Allies stationed in Italy began to search, capture, imprison and interrogate anybody who was suspected of being a former Italian Social Republic soldier. The Italian Social Republic soldiers who surrendered to the Allies during the war were imprisoned but usually had their lives spared. They were taken to prison camps in Texas and later in Italy itself, but unless they committed war crimes that the Anglo-Americans could prove, they would be released at the end of the war. This wasn't true for the many RSI soldiers who didn't surrender themselves to the Allies or to anyone else. Surrendering to Italian partisans or Yugoslav forces usually meant death. In the months after the end of World War II, there was a literal hunt for former RSI soldiers in Italy, made by both partisans and the Allies. Various officers and soldiers who took part in war crimes were trialed and then imprisoned or executed, but for many soldiers or low-rank officers, there was no such thing. If the partisans or the Allies could prove you were a former Italian Social Republic soldier, no matter if forcefully conscripted or volunteer, you would be executed on the spot without trial.
That is why many former RSI soldiers lied about their involvement in the war, indirectly giving a lot of uncertainty on the actual numbers of the Italian Social Republic forces. If they would have admitted it, they wouldn't have seen the sun rise the day after. But this hypothesis on Churchill's statement still makes no sense. If in the previous options he was ignoring the many Italians who were still fascists, here he's ignoring the many anti-fascist Italians in the resistance. This would be suggesting that up until the last day of the war, all Italians were fascist, and that the day after all Italians weren't, which implies once again that there was no civil war or no resistance. So, no matter how one can spin this statement, it still makes no sense, not even as a figure of speech. No matter the date, it ignores millions and millions of Italians and several hundred thousand soldiers or partisans fighting on one side or the other of the war. One could make a generalization of the British population, but not of the divided Italian population who took part in a civil war. Winston Churchill used this revisionist statement, among others, as a matter of propaganda and Anglo-Saxon superiority rhetoric, often twisting facts and events on other countries to make his country look great and his shortcomings during the war forgotten. Up until this day, Anglo-Americans' historiography, especially when written by right-wing historians, has been a proud supporter of this kind of statements. The malevolence and the lack of honor displayed by Churchill and many others in twisting and revisioning history to their advantage shouldn't be treated lightly. To conclude, I believe I gave a perspective from the other side of the story. Italian, unlike English, is not an international language, therefore it's easy to believe a story rather than another, given the enormous disparity between medias in English and in other languages. Of course, Italian revisionism does exist, and it mostly emphasizes World War I, but rarely does so for World War II, as history is written by the victors, therefore in this case, anti-fascists. In the end, Italian soldiers in World War II fought with what they had and managed to obtain good results at times. Under-equipped and with low morale, most of the times they had to face forces much greater than them and much more modern, but when the conditions were more favorable, they were able to put in serious danger divisions from the best armies of the world. And as much as they are not considered loyal, many of them chose to ignore the orders of their king and government, putting their lives and families in danger to remain loyal to their ideals and their foreign allies. They might have been on the wrong side of history, but no World War II soldier, whether volunteer or innocent victim of a regime, deserves to be forgotten, something revisionism has been trying to do since the dawn of time. Those who don't agree with this statement should have nothing to do with history.